There you go. Picks and bans for game number one, Najee and the Empire versus the Jin Air Green Wings. And we'll see what the bans look like here. Again, you know, we're on 5.12 today. Things have changed. Echo's probably not going to be seen anymore. Nidalee and Kalista bans, not too surprising. Again, Chaser played a great Nidalee, and she's only you know, that much stronger now with Runeglaive. Annie bans against Che, also pretty expected. Che is a monster on Annie right now. And the Gragas ban against Watch, too, so avoiding that first pick for Najin.
And there's the Rek'Sai. Yep. So these are pretty expected bans from Najin. This is usually what people like to ban out against Jhin Air. And they're targeting Chaser because he cannot be allowed to run amok like he did in their last series. Alistar is banned also, so the Evelynn will be first picked. Now, in the last series too, of course, we've seen a lot of changes to Ryze since then, but basically Jhin Air kind of baited Najin into taking Ryze both games and then just killed Duke over and over and over again. It was pretty one-sided, so they're going to grab the Eve. Now, this is going to put Chaser maybe in an uncomfortable position. No Cassiopeia ban so far, and will Kuzan go for the early Victor pick?
Maybe. I mean, if they... Yeah, with no Cassiopeia bans, a Victor pick would be... I mean, it's safe-ish, but you'd think they'd want to take the Cassiopeia away first? Or maybe try to counter-pick it more?
I think maybe you take the Ezreal right here, because if we think back to Goong's history, Goong was pretty darn good on Nidalee mid back in the day, and he is good at hitting long-range skill shots, also played Xerath. So,
you know, the other thing, though, too, is that Korea has never been, like, the fastest region at picking up new powerful things. So, I mean, they've gotten quicker over the time we've casted this league, but they still seem to take a while sometimes.
I don't know. I think we're going to see it come out today. It's so powerful if you start to ramp up that you do need to deal with that potential aspect of having it in the game. Now, The Nautilus pick here is a bit interesting, but Pure has overwhelmingly been picking Nautilus this season.
Yeah, well, he's not going to get it this time around. Victor locked in for Goong, and it looks like they're going to take the Maokai as well for Duke.
Interesting. Duke shying away from an early Rumble pick. Goong going back to the Victor.
Yeah.
Champion he played versus KT that he was... I mean... To be fair to Goong, he was about the only one doing well when he played Victor in the first game against KT. He actually had a fine individual performance on that champion. It just, the rest of his team sort of fell apart.
Yeah, he suffers from being shut down pretty hard by the other team sometimes. And Kuzan, you know, most of his games, and when I say most, I will say two of his games so far has been on Azir, so not a big surprise for him to pick that up. But maybe a little bit surprising into the Victor, though, huh?
So there we go. Yeah, the Azir into the Victor. I mean, the Azir should be fine, but the Lee Sin pick for Chaser, of course, there were three jungle bans this game, so we're getting pretty deep into the pool right now.
Runeglaive, Lee Sin. Just chunk him down with those Qs.
Oh, God.
Boom. Figured it out. Strategy analyzed.
So, OQ, maybe taking the Lucian just for the lane dominance. We don't know where that Nautilus is going yet. It could very well be a top Nautilus. Remember, Trace was the one who introduced top Nautilus to the professional scene.
Yeah, we're getting pretty deep in the support picks as well, too. I feel like Thresh should be fine for Pure, and maybe the Kennen actually was hovering over the bard for quite a while, but it's going to be the support Kennen. I suppose technically it could be support Maokai, but I'd imagine it's going to be the Kennen here.
Yeah, there will be. And this is just a very lane-dominant lane, looking for some early harass. And that's how Najin wins games. They kind of get OQ rolling. And we've seen them pick for lane matchups a lot, actually, and then have OQ just get completely out of control and very fed if Watch can get in there and get the ganks.
Well, OQ is one of the few AD carries to play the Lucian still as well. And if he plays it aggressively, he can certainly get a little bit of momentum going for his team.
Trace may be going back to the Rumble. I mean, he's played pretty much Rumble and Maokai almost exclusively this season. Yes, he played Hecarim in his last game against CJ, but he missed a lot of ults, and he wasn't looking too great on that champion. So Trace's champion pool is very small right now, but he gets away with it because Chaser has to have so many bans levied against him. You just can't let Chaser have a lot of these champions. So when you're trying to deal with that, it does make things a bit more difficult.
It's
so,
kind of like the bang getting to play Kalista effect. You know, there's just so many other bans on the team that some of those power picks sneak through consistently.
Yes, indeed. Well, taking a look at these team compositions, Jenner, not the best engage, but they're very good at kiting in this game. Very good at kiting with the Sivir. But they're going to have to rely on like an insect kick or an equalizer or something like that if they want to engage. Or Kuzan going in. Azir can be used as primary engage.
It seems like kiting is what you'd want to do against a clearly more aggressive Najin team. I mean, with OQ and Pure playing the bot lane that they are, I mean, you want to try to back off and not fight it head-to-head right away.
Yeah, we'll see what they could do. Expect to see a lane swap probably from Jhin'er here. I wouldn't want to be in that lane versus the Lucian and the Kennen on the Sivir. Najin has great engage, very well-rounded team composition. Should have better scaling also. Duke has a very good chance just to get unkillable.
Yeah, well, we'll see what happens here. Jhin'er coming in with the momentum in this head-to-head anyway. We'll see if they can keep it up with a win in Game 1. It's time to get in the game and find out. And welcome to Summoner's Rift. Welcome to Patch 5.12, Najin Empire versus the Jhin'er Greenwings here on Champion Summer. I'm not impressed by the cheer from the Najin fans. Yeah, Jhin'er okay too. People seem a little bit tired, a little bit fatigued. It's kind of a rainy day. It's maybe a little bit more dismal. I feel fine, but I can't speak for all the fans, I guess.
I guess the fans don't. Jeez.
Yeah.
Get it together, fans.
I don't know. Yeah, come on, fans. Where's your hype?
Where's your fanaticism?
If only they could hear us. They would be so hype then. They'd be like jumping out of the chairs. They'd be throwing chairs. Not at us, because we're great, but maybe at each other, like a mosh pit with chairs.
That sounds incredibly dangerous, Noah.
Well, these chairs are kind of like the light plastic ones, you know?
That's true.
So they're not, you could probably hit somebody with it and it wouldn't be too bad.
I'll experiment on you later.
No way, man. I'll dodge those chairs like Neo.
You won't see it coming. I'm going to sucker punch you with the chair.
I'm an SKT fan, man. You can dodge all the chairs. The KT fans look at us and like, wow, you move like Faker does. Like, yeah. Because we watch him all the time. She's a Najin fan.
She is.
And she has a curler in her hair.
She's
okay.
Curling her bangs. Oh. New fashion statement, perhaps,
that's
in
right.
Korea. Huh. Just leave the curlers in.
Maybe. Why not, you know? I've seen that on, like, sitcoms from time to time, but not in real life before.
Okay, so like pretty standard starts here. We're going to get standard lanes after no deep wards go in. So Pilot, I'm curious to see his Sivir. We've seen it in the past, but when you have somebody like Captain Jack, who is such a dominant Sivir player, a little curious to put Pilot in on this champion. Now, they are going to take the Gromp. So faster level 2 for the Jhin'er duo lane.
Yeah, OQ and Pure just kind of sitting in lane a little bit earlier, though, to get some decent positioning, and already some nice poke from OQ coming out onto Pilot.
This is a really brutal lane to deal with.
Yeah, no kidding.
They're trying to take just a little bit of an advantage so they wouldn't get all in right at level 2, but they just have to back off. So the Gromp really not doing a whole lot of work for them.
I was wondering about that when I saw it, because with Pure and OQ getting to lane so fast, I mean, well, you're just going to see what we just saw. You're just going to get zoned. Very hard and very fast.
Now they have to be careful, though, as they push forward, especially Chaser. You never know when, like, a Lee Sin's going to do a level 2 gank these days.
That's true.
Taking a look at our win rates. Watch 8-7 on Eve. 7-7 for Chaser. So Chaser hasn't played the Lee Sin in quite a while, though.
Yeah, and Watch has played Eve for probably the majority of his games this season.
Yeah, we take a look at the kill contribution percentage there. Chaser is number 1 in this league and has been the entire season for kill contribution. So he is the major player on his team that Jhin'er really revolves around.
Well, he was really high in the spring season as well, too.
Yeah, he's a very good jungler.
He's a good team player.
So, yeah, it looks like he's just going to take the blue buff, so nothing too exciting yet. We see Evelynn going back for the quick recall, and then going with the Stalker's Blade.
Yeah, okay. Huh. And we'll see if Watch decides to make any plays early. Ooh, speaking of early plays,
this
Goong
could be dangerous. Goong,
he might have to burn a summoner here. He's already at about 3/4 health. He's going to heal up a little bit, but Chase is going to come in before that happens. There we go, going in on the ward. He lands the Q. But Goong backs away without having to burn any summoners. Watch was right there, too, it looks like.
Yeah, you see how this Azir-Victor matchup goes. Usually the Azir has a pretty big poke advantage on the Victor, and so Victor has a tendency to fall behind in terms of CS during the laning phase. Now, of course, his burst potential extremely high all the same in the late game. Kuzan, dodge a death ray right there. Watch, trying to get in. Maybe force something out of Kuzan.
They're going to try it. Yeah, there we go. Kuzan having to get out. Took a lot of damage, but didn't need to burn any summoners because of Z.
Yeah, Soul has a pot running too, so yep. Nice just little pressure relief there from Watch.
True enough.
And yeah, this Lee Sin just not able to find that angle on the mid lane quite yet. Looks like Pilot's starting to balance things out a little bit, even though he has lost a few CS to the turret. So OQ and Pure going into that very dominant laning phase that we know them for. That is the Najin specialty. When we think about Najin, Duke and OQ have very good laning phases. The problem with Najin is putting it all together to actually get a win. Their individual talent isn't in question. Their teamwork, however, is a bit shaky.
Yeah. Oh, Jacer coming down for a lane gank here in bot lane. See if he's able to set anything up. I don't know. If Shake can land
out of the brush, too.
Yeah, if Shake can land a dredge line, maybe they can do it. But he tried, he missed, and now Watch coming up to the top lane here.
Yeah, look how safely Trace is playing this, though. He knows that Chaser was just seen in the bottom side, and now he's just going to back off and try and CS with his E. Watch still taking a look here, wants to come around and see if there are any Krugs to be had, but Watch will leave Krugless.
Krugless. Oh, that's the worst feeling ever. No Krugs. No Krugs at all.
Grompless, I think, is worse.
Grompless. It sounds like it totally should be a term for something else, you know? He was quite the Grompless individual. If we use it enough, it'll be in the dictionary in like a year or two. I was saying something like, if OQ wins, I didn't get to read the last of it. Or if Najin wins, OQ, blah, blah, blah. That's all you need to know.
Great translating,
though. Thank you. Perfect. I am done learning Korean. I have conquered that language.
Ooh, missed the cannon. This CS differential is really getting pretty severe at this point.
And yeah.
Chaser just hasn't found that angle yet. He's got to get something done here on this Lee Sin, or the Evelynn's just going to be much more useful in the late game unless Chaser wants to show off some pretty amazing Lee Sin mechanics to set up picks.
Yeah, we'll see. Looks like we might see a bit of a roam from Pure. Looks like they're trying to set up a dragon, maybe.
You can see the pink wards on either side of the river for Kuzan, because he wants to play this lane more aggressively, but Watch has been hovering around mid lane so much that Kuzan hasn't really been able to push the advantage as much as he wants to.
Yeah.
Now look at the ward in the mid lane also. Kuzan is known to roam, and he will tower dive you in a different lane on Azir. We've seen it happen before, so that ward is actually very good against Jhin Air, because then now they know if Kuzan is actually just backing off the minion wave to hide in the fog of war for a second, or whether he's trying to roam.
Right.
So I really like that. That's just a very, like, Kuzan-specific ward, because with most players, you would not put a ward in the lane that early, but I think against Kuzan, it's smart.
Well, Najin's done their homework for sure. I wonder if we're going to see, like, a level 6 all-in in bot lane. I feel like if you could get somebody stuck on the slicing Maelstrom with the culling on top of it, too, that'd be pretty good.
Yeah, and the Azir has control over that lane. Pushing forward right now, and so that's going to open up those roaming opportunities. Goong is likely going to be a little bit later.
Should be. Well, Chaser.
More pink wards, just replacing the one that was just killed. So they have extremely good information if Watch is trying to get around for a flank onto Kuzan. It's just not going to happen.
I think people are getting really good at handling Watch's Evelynn. I mean, it was never super difficult to handle, but people are really playing around it now.
Watch is also a very predictable jungler. Watch's main problem is that there's not a lot of variance in his play, and that's why junglers who are smarter, like Chaser, are so regularly able to abuse his pathing and make sure there are big advantages and that he gets held down.
Yeah. I think with all the Evelynn picks, he changes ID to don't watch, though.
Yeah.
You can't really watch him.
He just wants to see you to watch him while he's making the big plays.
That's right. He only wants you to see the big plays. Everything else, don't pay attention, because he does the same thing every game anyway, so gets kind of boring. Looks like that pink ward is going to get cleared out. They do see Pure and Watch coming in, though. So gank prevented. Now, last time these teams played, Jhin'Air just kind of won via some early kills and then just snowballing those. I mean, it was really just fighting from Jhin'Air that did the trick. But nothing too early this time around.
Well, and the fact that Captain Jack got Kalista in one of those games.
That tends to help a little bit.
Went nuts on it. So. Yeah, there were a lot of factors, but Jhin'Air, yes, those victories were incredibly clean. Now, looking at Jhin'Air recently, of course, again, in the CJ matches, they nearly won both of those games. And, in fact, probably almost certainly should have won game one. Oh, here we go.
Flash Dredgeline did not happen. Gets the ult onto Goong, though. Kuzan taking a ton of damage, though, in the meantime. Can't really follow that up.
Yeah, not hitting the hook. Pure there, just to make sure there isn't a re-engage that he needs to stick around. So they waited right until Che hit level 6 before attempting to make that play. But at the same time, Najin gets a lot of deep wards into Jhin'Air's jungle. So, Watch.
Oh, Watch gets caught. Kuzan bends a soldier around to get away because Goong was following up and Kuzan had already lost a little bit of health. Goong still has his ultimate, or had his ultimate too, so would have been able to do quite a bit of burst. I'm actually a little bit surprised he didn't use his ultimate in that little engage in the mid lane. I think he was level 6. I think he had just hit it at that point. Could be wrong, though. Well, not the best calling in the world, but they do get some decent damage in onto Che.
Yeah, the big story here is the insane CS difference that has opened up in this bottom lane of 35. I mean, Pilot is just having a really tough time, and I really like it when Najin plays this way, because I think this is the way that Najin is best able to win games. Just play the lane strength. Why not? That's what you're good at. Kuzan, a little bit low from the Chaos Storm, but doesn't have to use Flash.
Yeah, Goong still has his down for quite a while now. Oh, OQ getting really aggressive. Dashes in, but takes a lot of damage from Pilot.
At the same time. But look at how good OQ and Pure are at forcing Pilot to lose creeps to the tower. Mm. They harass at the right time, so he can't get those last hits. They can't freeze the wave. It's just very solid laning performance.
Yeah, and this is what we've come to expect from OQ and Pure over the course of the season, especially OQ. And the fact that OQ's cleaned up his late game, too, I mean, he's been having a pretty good season overall.
He's having a great season.
It's been the other parts of Najin that have been kind of struggling. And like you said, there's a lot of players on this team. And I feel like Jhin'Air kind of has the same problem, too. We were talking about this, where there's a lot of individually strong players, but they just don't seem to mesh terribly well together.
I think Najin's problem is that they don't have great shot calling. Hmm. And I think Jhin'Air's problem is that while the individual parts are all very good, there's something wrong with the synergy with the team and the fact that they don't really have a player that has stepped up to be a playmaker besides either Captain Jack or Kuzan. And Chaser, of course. You know, they need somebody else besides Chaser who is a bit more reliable to actually make the flashy plays to win them games.
It looks like we might have some action around Dragon here, but mostly just ward clearing by Jhin'Air. They missed the blue in their jungle, though. So Najin has a good idea of where everyone is. And will we maybe see a Dragon attempt finally from one of these teams? This has been a very long laning phase, it feels like. Oh, Watch spots Chaser.
I really don't want to go in on this. Watch still opting for the Warrior Enchant here on the Evelynn.
Yep.
Not going for that Rune Glaive in this particular instance. I think the Warrior might still be a better choice overall on Evelynn.
Chaser going for Cinderhulk for his enchant, actually.
You know how much I love Cinderhulk Lee Sin,
Stoa. I know, it's your favorite.
In this case,
I mean you hate it.
They do actually need another tanky member as part of the front line, especially since Sivir is pretty low range. So it could be justified within this particular composition, I feel. It's like Trace is going for Fast Abyssal Scepter. Also has the Merc Tread, so really conservative Rumble build. He's also behind in terms of CS. So we do have like that 1K gold advantage that's just been built off of CS leads, really.
Yeah.
From Najin in the top of the bottom lane.
Yeah, nearly 40 up in that bot lane for OQ. And Goong has been able to equalize. He was behind, but he's brought back the CS, and now takes a little bit of a lead himself.
Jhin'Air has to regain control of this bottom side. The fact that this CS lead has been allowed to develop, and certainly Watch and Pure have been very good about warding up the river and making sure that the ganks can't come in. You have to be able to get in there at some point in time and start to turn that around. Here we go.
Whoa! Goong. Nice move from Kuzan right into the clutches of Chaser. Misses the Q, though, and Goong might be able to get out of this one with a kill. There's the chilling smite. He flashes over the wall anyway. And Kuzan very low health. Q lands. Chaser comes in. Teleport's coming down. Equalizer used. First blood goes to Chaser. Kuzan gets out of the fight, but now Najin looking for some revenge. Not going to find it, though. Really
great
nice play
setup.
From Kuzan, man.
Really good setup from Kuzan
right
there on the Azir. Unfortunately, Chaser did miss a skill shot, so it wasn't as clean and actually got a lot more dangerous as a result of not hitting that Q.
But
he did eventually manage to get it. Had to burn a flash more than he would have liked to. Yes, very interesting situation, and the setup was very good, and that first blood coming through is going to be useful. Unfortunately for Jhin'Air, Kuzan did not pick it up. Instead, it went over to Chaser, but that's going to help clear up a little bit of this gold deficit.
Such a clean engage by Kuzan there, too. That was
Chaser,
pretty impressive.
Chaser also getting there first and not using teleport. He just walked down the river as soon as that went on to use the equalizer. So the fact is they now have TP advantage, and Trace was so neutralized in the games against CJ. He just looked like he was on a different page than the rest of his team. So the fact that he got there at the right timing is actually a big, big point in his favor compared to his last match. Najin can't go after this dragon without the TP. I don't know why they'd be making a play right here. They may just be trying to bait it, and there's the check. He's going to find Pure.
Seems fairly dangerous. I suppose they may be thinking they want to try it before Trace's equalizer comes up, but it comes up like now, so the window of opportunity for that is closed.
Yeah, they thought maybe they could make a pick with a face check, force a face check while Sivir was gone, because
that
there was a threat for that dragon, but Jhin'Air just approaches it cautiously, shoots the Q, and through the brush and gives it the information they need, and now they're able just to walk in and clear. Oh, Bloodthirster first onto Sivir. That is not ideal in terms of damage. That is how threatened Pilot is in this game, but there's not going to be a lot of damage coming out of that Sivir for quite some time now.
Yeah, no kidding.
So that's going to leave the damage has to be done by Rumble and Azir. And that's also going to make the Aegis much more efficient with Sivir's lower damage, because you're going to cancel out a lot of the AP damage with that. So that is bad. And Pilot really struggling, as we thought he might. I mean, Pilot is not doing well in this lane, but a large part of that is this ridiculous matchup he has to play into.
That's true. It still is a little bit surprising to see Pilot instead of Captain Jack, but maybe they'll switch back into him for the second game if this goes poorly. I mean, Jhin'Air still looking fine. They've caught up in gold more or less. And right now, at least, they have the Vision Round Dragon, so maybe they can take one of those in the near future.
Well, they have to get some pressure down onto this tower. Here we go. They're actually just going after OQ.
Yeah, ult onto OQ finally catches up. Oh, nice dredge line. Max range from Che, and they're going to get the kill. Pilot picks that one up. Great play from Che there to set that one up for his AD carry, and that's going to lead into an immediate dragon for Jhin'Air, and not a lot Najin can do about it. Watch lurking. They may try to make a play here on Pilot.
I mean, those were some great Nautilus
mechanics.
Pilot.
There's the ult. Yep, Pilot in a lot of trouble. Slicing Maelstrom comes in. Great answer from Najin. They're going to lose the dragon, but at least they get something in the bot lane.
Yeah, you have to be so cautious about that, especially since they knew Pure was going to be coming back.
Yeah.
So they get the dragon, but both AD carries really mispositioned without the supports around and fell prey to some pretty easy all-ins, actually.
Yeah. Well, that Kennen certainly doing work, at least, in terms of getting a bit of revenge anyway.
Yeah, Trace also uses Equalizer just to clear a wave during that engagement, looks like, in the top side. Didn't actually have to TP down. So Jhin'Air may just not even use this TP timing window that they've been given.
Well, I wonder if maybe they can set up a play in bot lane or something like that.
you'd think that's what they would do, right? Yeah. Given the current state of affairs down there. But Jhinnair, just because they've been so routinely pushed up in the bottom lane, you know, there hasn't been a lot of free time for Che to get out into the river to clear wards alongside Chaser. And it's too dangerous for Chaser to go down there alone to reclaim the vision.
And Najin's warding for OQ and Pure has been
really
very good at keeping them safe.
Yeah, and that's a big reason why OQ and Pure have been able to play so aggressively and get that big CS advantage that they've managed to acquire. So Najin playing around their bottom lane very intelligently in this game.
Yeah, it helps because, I mean, we saw just a moment ago how vulnerable OQ can be, you know, just how Jhinnair, if they find the opportunities, can get kills down there if they want to.
Well, that's if OQ is way too far out in lane while Pure is backing. I mean, that's just,
well,
that was silly.
That's an opportunity that happens once in a while on Najin. You know, maybe not as often this season, but it has been known to occur rather regularly before.
Yes, indeed. OQ playing recklessly is not something that Najin is particularly surprised by.
It's been a while since we've had an OQ moment. There's an ult onto OQ again. Gets caught. Slicing Mouse from activated to try to prevent some damage. Trace is right there. Teleports down. They're making their play. They get it. OQ gets taken out. Meanwhile, watch very low. So everybody from Jhinnair down the bot lane. That's two kills for them. Three kills for them, including a double for Trace. And Duke on the run as well. Uses TP to come down. And he'll be able to live with that ultimate. Jhinnair doesn't want to dive it. Well, maybe they do.
They keep pushing forward. They have Sivir, they have Azir. That turret's going to go down extremely fast.
There's the play.
Jhinnair set up that play extremely well. Trace, great teleport today. He has been in the right place at the right time. Looks like he's shaken off a lot of the problems that we saw him have against CJ. But Duke, late on the TP, and that's really problematic because Trace was there so early. And look at the setup, too. They set it up so beautifully. Kuzan had the mid lane control. They finally had the opportunity to get him to roam into the bottom side, and they make a five-man play, and Goon's just simply not there, and Duke is there too late.
Yeah.
So, really good play. OQ was trying to back, by the way. He was just using the culling so he could get back to base.
This is starting to look a little bit like how Jhinnair beat Najin last time, too. Just getting those kills and then kind of starting to snowball things. And it seems like once the bottom lane turret goes down, you know, once Najin can kind of, or once Jhinnair rather, kind of regains control of their bottom jungle, that good warding that Najin had earlier is going to start to fall apart.
Well, look at what Jhinnair did off of that. look how many wards they got in the bottom side.
Exactly.
They finally reclaimed control of this side of the map. And that was Najin's primary advantage in this game, and it has just disappeared. Najin now trying to make a final push onto this turret using about four people. They're probably going to get it. So they just brute force it by sending a bunch of people there. I don't think the Azir should have gone down there. I think Kuzan should have just stayed in the mid lane and put some damage down onto the mid lane turret and just had piloted Che back off. Because that turret was so low anyway that Kuzan was just kind of wandering around not doing much when he could have definitely got a good amount of damage onto the mid turret.
Right. Well, Trace able to get some damage down onto this top lane turret finally. It's not a ton, but it's something anyway. And meanwhile, that CS lead down in bot lane is still pretty high. I suppose the OQ might get some time to catch up.
Pilot has caught up, though, because of his kills and assists. That's
more or less.
Yeah, that is a big, big factor, and that got him back into this game.
He's got the static Shiv now as well, too. So, again, not like a ton of damage coming out for the Sivir, but she's got the pushing power, and she's got the survivability, at least.
And she also doesn't have to build Arm Penetration right away.
Yeah.
She can build a Blade or an Infinity Edge next and be totally fine, because the Last Whisper not going to be a major factor for a while. Duke is probably going to finish off a major MR item, given the damage output on Jhinnair.
You'd think so. I mean, he's got the Glacial Shroud right now, but would you think he's just going to go for Spirit Visage first?
Yes, probably, I would say. Spirit Visage or Banshee's Veil, we'll see what he thinks is going to be the better option.
Yeah.
Still no sign of an Aegis on Najin. Looks like they want to engage with a Randuin's instead, but that is bold.
Yeah.
Especially since Trace already has so much flat magic penetration.
Well, and Chaser's not going warrior or anything, too, so it's not like you need to worry about Lee Sin's damage.
No, definitely not. I really think that the lack of an Aegis on watch is going to be quite harmful in this game, especially after Trace got all those kills in the bottom side. So we're going to set up for another dragon right now.
Yep.
Jhin Air should have a pretty significant advantage going into this.
Yeah, they really seem to. Able to clear some wards, get a few of their own down as well, too. There are a lot of wards in the jungle, though, of Jhin Air right now from Najin. But
yeah.
Not immediately by the dragon pit, though. Oh, here we might have a bit of engage. No, just claiming that Rift Scuttler. I believe Jhin Air got it. Yeah, they did. Pretty sure. Yep, they did. And they're going to activate the dragon. So Najin, well, going to look for that engage, but Trace coming in for the flank, he could lay down a really nice equalizer if Najin tries anything here.
This is the perfect situation for Jhin Air. They want priority over the
objectives.
Grab
it. Oh, Dredgeline onto Duke, and here we go. Equalizer boxes in. Najin, they're going to turn right on Jhin Air, though not afraid. Pure gets kicked out. Slicing Maelstrom doesn't do a lot, and there's the Emperor's Divide pushing everybody into the Flame Spitter from Trace. A little bit low health, though, so he's going to back off. And Jhin Air taking a loss on their side with Shay getting taken out, not getting any kills, but they did get the dragon, and they should be able to push this mid lane a little bit, so not bad overall.
Jhin Air really can't play that composition in this fashion. Yes, it was a good hook from Nautilus, but you want to kite generally with the comp like this. You don't want to engage right there because Najin has so many options. Now, Trace tried to cut them off with the equalizer and just prevent a retreat up the ramp.
Yeah.
But it doesn't do any damage. And they need him to do damage because he has all the kills. So they get some damage down. Pure does a great job of zoning out the team, as well as Duke. And the flank from the Rumble, that's not a thing that works. I mean, Rumble flanking, pretty ineffective. Kuzan also decides not to go all in. I think that he definitely probably should have tried to go further in instead of just pushing people away with his ultimate. So a bit of a misplay there, I think, from Jhin Air in terms of how they were going to play out that team fight. It would have been much more effective if Trace was either with the rest of his team or if Jay just hadn't engaged. Just, you got the dragon, just go ahead and kite it out,
well,
or
kinda
retreat to the mid lane. You don't have to fight that.
I kind of thought the equalizer was going to kind of come down in the middle of the Najin team to say, all right, either half of you have to come over this to engage, or the other half of you have to escape over it to get away, and maybe they can get a couple picks with chasing there. But
yeah, it wasn't the best decision for the equalizer. I know what Trace was thinking when he tried to do that,
right,
that he just wanted to cut off the escape route. But he's such, because Sivir isn't doing damage yet, he has to do damage with the equalizer. It is necessary because he's the one who's fed.
Yeah. Either way, doesn't work out bad for Jhin Air. They still got the dragon. And they can give up a kill to Najin. They got a lot of pressure in the mid lane as well, too, out of that. We'll see what happens next, though.
Yeah. Kuzan just taking a look at the blue buff right here.
Here we go. Teleport's okay. Coming in. Ult used by Watch. They're going to try to chase down Chaser. Che has a flash to get away. Emperor's Divide used for the disengage. Trace teleport in. Oh, they got Che again. Goong managed to help Duke pick him off, it looks like.
Yeah, nice teleport. They forced a lot of summoners in exchange for just the TP and the Righteous Glory. Now, they're not going to get an objective for it, but they also got Trace's TP, who is just reactively TPing to the mid lane. So, got to be careful. Che caught out a little bit, playing perhaps a bit too aggressively, and now they're going to lose a turret. So Najin doing a great job of capitalizing on the pick they managed to find.
Yeah, watching Pierre can kind of zone for OQ while he takes that out. And Najin really striking back, taking a gold lead, taking a turret lead. And Goong being very aggressive in the mid lane at the same time, which kind of keeps Kuzan from getting the opportunity to roam.
Yeah, and that's going to be pretty big here. Kuzan also starting to lose some of these trades with the victor as he gets more and more AP. We saw his damage onto Che. And more wards need to come down for Jhin Air. Jhin Air, really interestingly, now what Jhin Air normally does is get like four warding totems and upgrade them, right?
Mm.
That's been like the Jhin Air style this season that we saw against CJ. And basically they just put so many wards down that you can't clear them all. And because Jhin Air is a team that likes to kite, they like to kite, they like to bring you and draw you into them, and what they're really good at is warding and warding their flanks. Now, in this game, we don't see that coming in from Jhenaire. That's been a big part of their success, and going for so many sweepers is very uncharacteristic of them.
Yeah, well, we'll see if they're able to maybe get enough vision later on to, or enough maybe map control, I should say, to switch over and start to ward again. I wonder.
I think it's also just a difference between GBM and Kuzan's play styles. Because GBM is definitely one of the few mid laners who really likes to go for that upgraded warding totem. But it's resulted in fewer than normal Jhenaire wards on the map this game.
Yeah. Looks like Pilot might be going for the Last Whisper here. Is there really any armor on the other side, though? Not a lot. Do you think it's maybe just for the IE instead? It's going to be a long time before
it's going to be a Last Whisper. I think it should be an IE. I think that is the better choice, but that is not the choice the Pilot is making. In terms of the immediate benefit, IE would be substantially better. Well, Frozen Heart was just completed.
Oh, okay.
Tough call. It was just finished, though.
Well,
still,
we'll
Pilot really not going to be doing a whole heck of a lot of damage.
And that makes it too bad, too, that the some of the kills have gone on to Chaser and not on to Kuzan. He hasn't been able to quite power up as much. I guess he did just get his death cap, so he's got a decent amount of damage. Still no Aegis on the other side for Najin, so they are still going to take a lot of damage.
Very questionable. That equalizer is really going to hurt if it hits the back line.
Well, people get stuck on the equalizer with sand soldiers running them through.
There's so much magic penetration on Trace right now. Basically, his spells are going to do like true damage to people. That's really, really scary for OQ and Pure in particular.
Well, we'll see what happens as this third dragon comes up here.
I mean, Jhenaire has to get priority over this. They need to be at the dragon first so that they can just force the engagement from Najin.
Well, they're not. Jhenaire coming in now. Can they re-engage that dragon going down very fast?
They can't really engage right here is the problem.
Yep. Zoning with gravity. Najin does take the dragon. Jhenaire pops the Silver Ultimate, but not really finding an opportunity. It looks like they still want to fight. They've got Najin kind of bottled up. They're going to back away. Calling used. OQ trying to take a chunk out of Kuzan, which he does. Wow, Duke going way in, and here comes the Slicing Maelstrom as well. Equalizer comes down to sort of split up Najin a little bit. Trace manages to make it out. There's some knockups there. Kuzan manages to zone out OQ, but Goon coming over the wall gets the kill onto Kuzan. Chaser comes in, has to escape with the safeguard, but Watch is going to flash to try to get him with the hate spikes. Duke coming in for the kill. So tanky, he's going to be just fine, and Najin really responding well to that kind of awkward engage from Jhenaire. I suppose Najin was one that engaged
Trace
initially.
Trace recalled and then came back in. And Jhenaire, they didn't have the Sivir ult because they looked for it. They can't engage with this composition. That is not what this composition does. So they need to get in front of the dragon first and then try to take it and force the engage from Najin. So they eventually got it, but by that time they didn't have the Sivir ult anymore. And Pilot just isn't doing damage this game.
And they're not even going to get a turret off of the damage that Najin took or anything like that either.
No, definitely. Jhenaire just a little bit confused. It's so weird because this is a composition that Jhenaire is known for playing.
Yeah, but
this is what they want to play, or they've always wanted to play, and they
no GBM though, and that makes you wonder, you know, how much of the shot calling with this type of thing comes from him.
Well, also Jack, a major shot caller on this team,
that's for sure too. That's a good point. So I would imagine, you know, if this doesn't work out with, like you said, you know, with this being such a common comp that Jhenaire has success with in the past, you'd have to imagine they're going to do some roster swaps.
Yeah,
it's too late in the season to be experimenting more than a little bit, you know?
And I think you put Jack in.
Yeah,
you can leave Kuzan in. Kuzan's not having a bad game. He had some impressive Azir moves to actually zone out OQ in the last one.
Yeah, as long as you have some good shot calling.
Yeah, he was putting a lot of pressure onto the back lines, and his Azir mechanics have been very good.
Yeah. Yeah, he probably saved Jhenaire from losing another person or two by keeping OQ so far away. I mean, he died, but could have been worse. Dragon either way, though, for Najin. They start to come back a bit.
Yep, just a little bit. And Yeah, they're just poking out right now. And Kuzan going to hop over the wall to avoid the death ray. A lot of turrets still left on the map right now.
Yeah, only three turrets down in 34 minutes. That's a little bit surprising.
Yeah, very low turret game. Been all about fighting around this dragon and fighting on the bottom side of the map.
Which is kind of similar to what we saw in this, these two organizations' last meeting. It was a lot of fighting. And it wasn't until, you know, those fights became catastrophic for one side that we really saw a lot of turrets go down.
So, yeah, the pilot finally going to start moving into that Infinity Edge. Maybe he'll be able to do damage after that, but Duke's starting to gear up for a Thornmail at this stage, and he's also nearly level 18. So he is getting quite scary.
Yeah.
And Najin just dialing up the pressure right now. They have control over all the side waves. Doing a good job of it. Kuzan has been valiantly defending mid. There's still hardly any damage on either mid lane tier 1.
Well, I suppose we have two rather high wave clear mid laners with a lot of damage on them, so it's going to be tough to push forward in that lane anyway. Oh, Sivir-Alt activated, and immediately the Culling goes down. Teleport coming in from behind Jhin'Air. Watches right there. Nice three-man ultimate. Che tries to get away, has to flash over the wall. Here comes Pure. If he can land a Slicing Maelstrom, they might be able to get a kill, but it doesn't look like it's going to happen.
Chaser!
Whoa! Chaser goes in. I don't know about that. Gets a big kick. They get the ult out of Pure. Can they make something happen? A little bit of damage coming in from Kuzan over the wall. And Pure very low. Goom slowed down. Equalizer was used, but they didn't really have any follow-up. So, again, Jhin'Air just looking a bit disjointed.
Well, Trace actually got a really good ult, and Chaser getting in there. They chunked everybody out so low that they're going to be able to take a tower off of this, so definitely not the worst thing in the world. Goom's going to attempt a response, and see he still has HP and mana to push into the mid lane and try and chase Trace off, but he's not going to get much done here, even though he drops the Chaos Storm. So, you know, Jhin'Air, they forced the TP out, so they're going to have TP advantage. They didn't commit when they saw the TP come in. They got themselves out of a sticky situation. And then Chaser goes back in, plays some interference, and they drop a very important equalizer that gets them a turret. So now they're going to have TP. That actually worked out pretty well from Jhin'Air in terms of how they disengaged the fight and then re-engaged it. They definitely made the plays and got the objectives afterwards. So it could have been done better, but they did actually make the right calls.
Oh, we'll see if they can get the dragon as it comes up here. That'll be the next big moment in this game, and it's coming in 20 seconds, too. It's not too long. Jhin'Air with not a ton of time to get set up for that one.
If I'm Jhin'Air right now, I just start threatening Baron. You have control over the side waves. If they start to, yeah, you could see Najin is really scared that this could actually happen because they have TP.
Well, it could actually happen. There's a lot of damage from Jhin'Air, too.
And Jhin'Air right now, they just need to keep Najin wandering around in the middle of the map while that bottom wave develops and maybe get some damage onto the tier 2. No one from Najin can safely go clear that out at the moment without Jhin'Air getting position on the dragon. So
that's a good point.
They're in a really good position, actually, surprisingly.
And Najin's going to activate that dragon anyway. Now, what's Jhin'Air going to do? Are they just going to trade a mid lane for it? Or they're going to go for dragon, or Baron, rather. They're rushing Baron at the moment. That bottom lane's still pushing, too. And actually, Najin disengages from the dragon. They can't do it.
Jhin'Air just giving Najin the runaround right now, and there's nothing that Najin could do to actually take this.
Well,
they're going to take that out. And there's a huge minion wave at the bottom side.
Whoa, Kuzan taking a lot of damage, though, getting majorly chunked out in mid, and that may cost him the turret and the dragon.
Yeah, that was a mistake from Kuzan. Nice culling.
Yep.
Still no one there, and Kuzan going to have to recall right now. Big wave in top for Jhin'Air, but they can go clear it because they have teleport.
They don't know that Kuzan recalled, too. They're still going to do the dragon, but
yeah, two-man two-man dragon for Najin, so nice call, but it costs them a tier 2 turret. I mean, Jhin'Air, under the circumstances, did okay, but Kuzan getting caught out with the culling was really the big thing in the mid lane. OQ landing that gave them the turret and the dragon instead of just the dragon. And it got them enough security and peace of mind by being able to shove up right to the tier 2.
Kuzan has been really good this game, but it's small things like that, kind of a little bit of a rookie era that might give Najin kind of an edge.
He had a weird recall timing, which forced Jhin'Er to kind of like walk up to the Baron, and it did work to delay Najin, but it could have been... If Najin had realized that Kuzan wasn't there, they would have just gone straight for the dragon and not
cared. Of course, yeah.
So, not so sure about his recall in that particular instant, that point in time.
Well, Najin just hanging out in the mid lane. I mean, Jhin'Er still has a lot of control around the Baron.
Pilot finally does damage now.
Yeah, he's got his IE. Finally. All right, it's your turn there. Ult used by Watch, but no follow-up for Najin just yet. A little bit of damage to Kuzan. And here comes Duke to zone out the entire team. Very tanky. A lot of gold on Goong right now to be spent.
Yeah, gold is very even across the board. Oh, they found Watch there. Just going to do a little tussling. Watch, very tanky at this point in time, has the Veil and is working on the Randuins.
Yep. Chiefs are very tanky, so he can't afford to jump in and do that kind of thing. They've got the Aegis as well now at this point.
Yeah, had to get it on the support after the Glory.
Right.
Not ideal, but at least they finally have one. Trace is slowly working his way up to Azonia's Hourglass. He really needs that item so that he can provide more frontline for Jhin'Er, because that is something that they're definitely lacking at the moment.
Now there's a big wave building up in bottom in favor of Najin. That side wave control has been lost a little bit by Jhin'Er.
Yep, they need to go deal with that, but they have to wait a while because they don't have any wards on the bottom side.
Yeah.
So, naturally, Trace is going to be quite worried about heading down there by himself. So, Najin just trying to delay as much as possible, make sure they can just continue to ward up around the Baron, maybe force a bait. That's what they should be looking for at the moment.
That makes sense. Najin does have the wards around Baron now as well, too.
And basically, we're just waiting for that bottom wave to do something. And so now Najin,
Trace.
If Trace goes out this far, Najin needs to think about collapsing on him.
He will kill that wave really fast, though, so you think he could probably get away.
He has the Liandry's, so that's going to be very useful.
Yeah, the wave's going to disappear extremely quickly.
But Najin not really doing anything with this point in time. Actually, in spite of their really good engage, they're not trying to make a play into the enemy jungle. Feel like there's a bit of a missed opportunity.
Yep, Trace is just going to recall immediately after taking out that wave, and he's still got that teleport to come in if he needs to. Looks like everybody recalling, just time to buy.
Zonia's complete. That is a huge buy for Trace here.
Yep. That's going to help a lot with the Baron fights that are going to be coming up.
Yeah, Pilot looks like he's going to be wanting to go Veil also. So just trying to deal with some of the engage from Evelynn and Maokai in case they manage to get flanks and get into the back line. That's going to be a really good buy for an AD carry in this game. It's like OQ heading the same route, but that's mostly just to eliminate some of the magic damage that's going to hit him because Equalizer exists.
Yep, he also doesn't want to get the Lee Sin Q on him to possibly set up for a insect kick. Najin threatening Baron, though. They're actually going to start it. Jhin'Er, Chaser was a little bit out of position. Here they come. Can Jhin'Er stop this Baron going down very, very slowly?
There.
That's right. There's a ward. Can they stop it? Najin gets the Baron. There's the Equalizer. Doesn't do really anything. And now Jhin'Er has to try to chase this down, but they just don't have the team to do that with. Culling used for just a moment by OQ. Actually, not used at all. Never mind.
Watch actually getting out just on the barely on the range of vision, but
Chaser
was not there to even attempt to steal. There's the culling.
They're going to try to engage here. Pure almost there for the slicing mouse, and he's going to flash in. Doesn't get a lot done with it. Kuzan over the wall, pushes people back with the Emperor's Divide. Doing some decent damage. They're going to jump in onto Duke again. Chaser getting very low, taken out by Goong and that Chaos Storm. Jhin'Er going for the re-engage, but it just does not work. Wow, Kuzan nearly blown up by OQ as well, and this is almost certainly going to cost Jhin'Er a tier 2, if not more.
Yeah, just trying to re-engage right there without the Equalizer, very risky. And Jhin'Er, this is the problem with a composition like the one Jhin'Er runs. If the enemy, if you're playing a kite comp like this, and they are the ones on Dragon or Baron, it's so hard to get in there to stop them.
Yeah, and they're going to lose an inhibitor because of this as well, too. Jhin'Er starting to kind of fall apart now. And you have to wonder if Jhenaire is going to be able to come back in this one. It's looking like Najin's game at this point.
Yeah, definitely is. Certainly is still very close in terms of gold for 44 minutes into this game, but...
The leverage that Najin has on the map is hard to
deny. Also just have way better scaling, so it's going to be difficult, I think, to come back from this. Kuzan actually does a nice job bouncing everybody and getting him in a corridor. And if you could imagine, if Equalizer was up right there, laying it down right after the Emperor's Divide would have been amazing. But
for the most part, Trace's Equalizers haven't been very good this game.
He's had a couple good ones, but, I mean, what was he supposed to do? He had to shoot it into the pit, otherwise it was guaranteed that Najin was going to be able to get the dragon.
Yep, dragon
or get the Baron, rather, because Chaser was still running to the pit. It was a good call from Najin to start it at that time.
And dragon number three now for Najin. And just going to go ahead and take another turret down in bot. Not a lot else to be said.
Jay using the glory, but not actually convincing OQ to stop culling or putting pressure on the turret. So it's just a prolonged siege right now as the siege minion shoots those purple cannonballs.
It's like righteous mediocrity.
Yeah.
Not really glorious. Kind of average. And the turret continues to take damage from that Baron-powered cannon minion. Here comes the next wave. There goes the turret. And Najin is just becoming this steamroller that Jhenaire just kind of has to get out of the way of.
Yeah, and now Jhenaire just going to be clearing out those waves just a little bit, but they can't quite get it down. Now the Baron's almost gone.
Yeah.
So they actually, this is smart. They don't want to commit too much to this. They may lose a tier two thanks to two cannon minion waves in the side lane, and Jhenaire going to try and delay. They see Goong on the run, so they're going to prevent some people from leaving, and that's going to be another tier two just with the minion wave. Second time Jhenaire has gotten one this game.
Yeah, not bad. What's surprising to me is that now they've gotten both tier twos down in the top and bottom, but they still haven't gotten the mid lane tier one yet. It's a little bit surprising.
Well, there's been a lot of defense in the mid lane from Najin, and of course Victor's wave clear is excellent. But yes, this is looking quite good for Najin, but Jhenaire has a chance now because there's no Baron or Dragon that they have to fight. They can just wait for their inhibitor to come back up and they'll be ready to fight again at another objective. Yes, it's not looking good. Yes, they are going to get outscaled, but that doesn't necessarily mean they can't find that good team fighter, that good pick. Trace has, you know, Duke's been a little bit late this game, and if they can abuse that and find a 5v4, so considering that Trace has been more on the money when it comes to using the teleport and showing up at the right time for team fights, could go their way.
Well, yeah, I mean, if Goong or OQ gets caught, that fight could be won very quickly for Jhenaire, and then they could very quickly take a couple turrets out of it. Or maybe Baron. Who knows?
I like how OQ is six items in this game, a 0-2-1 Lucian.
It's a lot of gold.
In spite of dominating that laning phase, and looking good in teamfights, and also using that culling at very key moments. Yeah. His cullings, while they haven't gotten kills, they've gotten a lot of towers by pushing people off.
Right. Well, Kuzan especially can tell you how that feels. He's got his Zhonyas now, so Jhenaire can maybe be a little bit more aggressive, which I feel like they kind of need to be right now. They need to
Jhenaire just trying to set up a death brush. They have a few wards in.
Yeah.
You see Watch popping some down. They were hoping that there might be a siege onto the tier two, so they were allowing this minion wave to develop. They may go back up there and try again. Let's see if Najin falls for the bait. They don't know. They should strongly suspect this is going on, but they don't know. And Najin's like, well, we're not going to walk up there right now. We have a minion wave. Just push in the mid lane.
Yep, why not?
All right, now they're pinging that turret, but Jhenaire's already fallen back.
And they could try to push that bottom inhibitor, too, at some point. Because right now the wave is pushing in favor of Najin. Looks like they'll be able to get this tier 2 unless Jhenaire does something drastic right here. Nope.
Watch is just so tanky, able to get there a little bit early, tank the turret while they waited for the minion wave, and then back off. So another tier 2 in favor of Najin. Remember, they're only 5k gold up. This is technically still a winnable game for Jhenaire, even if it is very unlikely.
They just need that perfect team fight. And they've certainly gotten practice this game, but they need Trace to have a really amazing equalizer. I think that's kind of the heart of it.
Yeah. There is an issue that Najin did take the Baron and the Dragon very close together. So Jhin'Air may be able to squeak out with something if they get lucky and they can delay the Dragon long, or the Baron long enough for the Dragon to spawn. They have to try something like that at the very least. And they don't have any wards really in their top side. So there's a lot of Fog of War for Najin to play with. Duke is absolutely massive at the moment.
It's going to be very, very hard to kill, to say the least. And now, finally, the Tier 1 mid. Will it go down? Watch coming in for the engage. He gets all over Pilot. There's the ultimate. Hits three people. That's a good equalizer. Trace comes in. Can he do enough, though? Pure got some damage done with the Slicing Maelstrom. There goes Nautilus immediately. And now they're getting in on the back lines. Trace pops his Onias. Pretty good wall setup, but it doesn't stop Pilot from getting taken down. And it looks like Jhin'Air is going to lose this team fight. Whoa, OQ going deep. He's going OQ. He's got the double kill, and it looks like he's going to be able to grab the triple as well. There it is. Meanwhile, another one for Goong, and that is an ace, and that should be the game with the Death Timers.
Beautiful Lucian play from OQ. But the real hero of this game is Duke. Duke got to the point where Jhin'Air's composition just doesn't have enough damage to kill a six-item yep. Maokai. He is so tanky, and he took nearly no damage in that engagement. And OQ playing much more reserved until he knows it's time to strike and moves Man. Forward through the teamfight for a triple.
He did. Triple kill, and there goes the Nexus. Najin not going to get 2-0 this time. GG.
Very nice play from OQ. And even though he didn't even have any kills up until that point in the game, his lane dominance was really what caused Najin to get control of the pace of the game right at the beginning.
Yeah.
And he kept up there in terms of damage, got the critical cullings that allowed his team to take more turrets. And Najin, looking quite good that game overall, did have some mistakes with Duke's teleports, but we've come to expect that about Najin. Now, Jhin'Air, that was a composition that they should have been very comfortable playing, but they really dropped the ball on execution. Uncharacteristic.
You are a horrible person. And on that note, it's time for picks and bans for on that bombshell. It's time for picks and bans for game number two. Jhin'Air versus Najin Empire. Sivir banned. Just like I could ban the thoughts in my mind.
You can't.
No, I can't.
I'm just there to constantly fill your mind with new and exciting thoughts.
I don't know if I describe them well, new, yeah, but maybe definitely not exciting. Mm-hmm.
I know you too well. Anyway, Sivir and Annie going to be banned. Jhin'Air actually banning the Annie, interestingly enough, this game.
Yeah.
Will they ban the Rek'Sai as the final ban here for Najin? That would give over Alistar to Che, however. But Jhin'Air will 100% pick Rek'Sai first. And if they're thinking right now, they could get one of them. There's the Cassiopeia ban, probably pretty smart.
Yep, good to ban out against Goon. And what's that final ban going to be for Najin?
They could leave both of them up. Jhin'Air also really likes to first pick Victor if GBM is playing. They definitely have no problems about first picking Victor on blue side for GBM. They're very confident in his abilities.
True.
And Nidalee it's going
ban.
To be Nidalee. Ah, so,
okay. And there is a Victor first pick, just like you said. Yeah. Well, I mean, GBM has had great games on it.
And since Rek'Sai and Evelynn are both up, I guess they're not too concerned. But Alistar falling pretty far down, they're probably just going to take Rek'Sai Alistar here. I don't know why you wouldn't do that.
Do you maybe grab Maokai if they do that as well, too? Because Duke had such a good game on him, and Maokai is such a strong pick.
You could, but you really want to deny that Alistar because you want to open up the possibility of the duo lane.
I meant, does Jhin'Air grab Maokai right away
if Najin doesn't
right now? Yeah.
I think that would be a wise decision.
Because I agree, Rek'Sai Alistar seems like the way to go for Najin, but then if you're Jhin'Air, you should take the Maokai away.
Yeah, if I was Jhin'Air, I would take probably Eve. Not ideal into Rek'Sai, of course, with that Tremor Sense, but you kind of got to do it.
Yeah.
Take the Eve, and then the Maokai here.
The Maokai. The one and only Maokai.
You can take Sivir, too.
Except no substitutes.
You can take Sivir. Actually, Sivir Maokai is probably the best choice.
You can't take Sivir.
Oh, it's banned.
She's banned.
No.
She's been banned.
Jana. Oh,
Jana Maokai. Okay. Well, Che's played a little bit of Jana. I mean, it's been Nautilus, Annie, and then the few games that he's played something else has been more or less Jana.
So they are going to be playing. Jhinair likes to play kite comps with Victor.
Well, they certainly will be again. I mean, it's pretty much written on all over their picks and bans so far. There's no real mystery about what Jhinair is going for here.
No, they're
going
to pick Corki, too.
Yeah, for sure.
If Najin doesn't take Corki, then Jhinair will. The question is, do they want to get that Lucian again if you're Najin? Because they did so much work in the laning phase in the 2v2 that maybe you actually save your AD carry for last pick right here. Goong's in a bit of trouble, though. I don't know what Goong is going to play.
Maybe the Azir.
That is not a Goong champion.
Not really. See him pondering it on the screen. He is going to go with the Azir, and it looks like it's going to be the Gnar for Duke.
Hmm. Curious.
Yeah. All right. I suppose you could do a Kog'Maw here, couldn't you?
Yes, absolutely. Kog'Maw definitely viable.
Wow, Kog'Maw Nunu, yeah. It's about as kite and poke as it gets.
Indeed. And the great... Actually, I really like what Jhinair did here.
Yeah.
So they're just going to invade. Let's think about the last game and what Jhinair's problems were. They didn't have great warding, and they didn't have deep wards in the early game, so they found it very difficult to make plays or to keep Najin from repeatedly pressuring the lanes, especially bottom. Well, Nunu is going to be able to counter jungle and get those deep wards in quickly. Kog'Maw is very good in the laning phase.
Ah, Tristana. Okay.
So OQ may be going back to Tristana. That is one of his staple picks. And the Kog'Maw has enough peel in this composition, and the Kog'Maw won't lose lane as badly because of that long range early.
Hmm.
And Jhana Kog'Maw is a difficult lane to deal with in terms of harassment because you do get poked out from so far away with the Bioarcane Barrage early on.
Yeah.
So I really like this adaptation from Jhinair, actually.
Well,
I think they did a very smart draft to shore up the weaknesses that they had in the last game. And maybe with GBM here, they're going to remember how to kite.
Maybe. Maybe. Remembrances of kiting. Sounds like a Lifetime Channel movie special about this tender family relationship about how they flew kites, but then somebody died, and then they had to move on with their lives or something. Yeah, very touching. And then in the end,
I look forward to your screenplay, Noah.
Yeah, because in the end, GBM shows up on Victor and is just like, Death Ray, and yeah.
Kills an entire family. Well,
there you go.
Good job, GBM. You're now a mass murderer.
You're now a serial killer.
So,
and then actually what happens is at the end, the mother puts on a Victor costume, and then she doesn't. She says, ganked by mom at the end. That's right. And then the credits roll. It's a surprise.
You really missed your calling.
You could have been
such a good writer, Noah.
I know. I had sci-fi original features all over, right? Pretty much what I'd be going for.
You should apply to the Riot Lore Department. Here, they need people of your quality and your caliber right
what
now.
What would you do without me, though? We'll find out as we move into game number two. Well, that was ominous. Jhinair Green Wings versus Najin Yemfire. Game number two. The crowd a little bit more pumped up after that one. Slightly more pumped. The hype is marginally better.
I like how they put Pilot on the Kog'Maw too, because he is most known for his caster style carries.
Yeah, he's
and
he's,
so
he's
the Trinity Force carry
gonna
suit him well. And so I think this is a very interesting adaptation for Jhinair.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Najin, on the other hand, going to be very reliant on Pure for engages, but they have a ridiculous amount of crowd control on their composition. So OQ should be able to get a lot of free auto attacks with this composition.
You know, this Maokai skin makes me wonder, is it wise if you're a giant tree to carry around a lantern with an open flame on the back of your head?
Probably not. You think if he falls over, he's going to light himself on fire.
Yeah. I don't think that's smart at all. somebody bumps you accidentally, you know, if you're like walking, you know, through the door to like a, your local supermarket.
Oh, yeah, it's like a it's not a lantern, it's actually a brazier.
Is it?
Yeah, it's just an open pan full of coals. That's
well, that's a terrible idea.
Maokai has a death wish.
Wow. Maokai.
He likes to live dangerously, Doa.
Well, I hope he...
What is it even for?
To see... Well, yeah, yeah, you can't even light the way in front of him. All it does is cast a shadow in front of him, which makes it harder to see things. Maokai, you idiot. Wow. Today we learned Maokai is an idiot.
Maokai confirmed stupid and suicidal.
Stupid Maokai. I hope he dies. What a moron.
It would be funny if his death animation was him falling over into that lighting.
Seriously, right? Missed opportunity there. See, that's why we don't see any like walking, talking trees anymore. That's why evolution has selected them to not be around, because they all carried around open braziers and fell over and lit on fire. The more you know. It's a running joke now. We'll see how this bot lane goes. It's certainly not going to be, I think, the same level of pressure.
Oh, they came from America.
Yeah. And that's hilarious, according to the crowd.
Oh, they always laugh at me when I say I came from America.
Yeah. Whenever I tell
people...
Oh, wait,
no, that's Korean solo queue. Never mind.
That's true. Yeah, that's right. They're like, oh, no, now everything that goes wrong in the game is your fault. Yep. So you just have to learn enough Korean to sound rude, and then they're like, well... A foreigner wouldn't be rude to us in Korean. He must be Korean too, and then things are okay. That's my strategy on the Korean server.
My strategy is just to be rude in real life.
That's true. But then everyone thinks you're from America.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of the opposite effect, isn't it? Oh well. Didn't have to flash for that snowball. Eating the scuttle crab.
Delicious crab.
I was in Busan this last weekend. I ate lots of delicious crab.
How delicious was it?
So delicious. Incredibly delicious.
Oh, look, he's still doing a good job of denying CS by pushing this wave under the tower. Pilot having a really hard time farming under the turret today.
I'm frankly surprised that... I mean, yeah, you've got the sustain from Alistar, but still, I would like to see the aggression of Che. You know, if he's... shielding himself and going in for the trades there, because I feel like poking like that, might help a bit. Leave the Kog'Maw on his own. He should be positioning well anyway. It's not his fault if you take damage. You just need to get the money, Che. You need to get the auto attacks in.
Get that sweet support gold.
That's right. You need to build that Magi's as fast as you can.
How else are you going to have 1,000 damage tornadoes?
Yeah, seriously. So basically, Che is playing this completely wrong. That's what we're trying to say. But I think it's just a real testament to Okyu and Pure, just how they've been able to push this lane up. They're such a good duo lane. Easily one of the best right now.
Yep. Excellent in the laning phase. Never been a problem for Nanchen. That early game has been a strength of theirs. So
yeah.
Chaser now going to wander through Tribrush. It has just been warded. And he has his Sightstone, of course, first on Nunu. So he's calmly placing a ward in the river.
And I wonder how aggressive he's going to be with the invading, with the jungle camp thievery over on Najin's side. You'd have to expect it's going to come fairly soon. Ooh, watch. Stealing the raptors in the meantime. Saying, well, Nunu's probably in my jungle, so I might as well. But he's not.
Definitely is not.
He's taking the Krugs right now. He's got Krugs.
Chaser has walked through the same minute trinket ward like 3 times now, so they know exactly where he is. Chase here. They just want to push this up, actually, and get the duo out of lane. So it's not really a gank or anything like that. They just want to give some time for Pilot to go back and buy, it would appear, or reverse the pressure on the wave. But if you be careful. Watch is just there. He knows that Nunu is going into his own jungle. Pilot and Che backing off.
Yeah, it's a little bit too dangerous for them to be pushed that far forward now. And Chaser does get the opportunity to take the Rift Sculler, I suppose, so that's kind of nice.
Wow, watch really waiting for this one.
Oh boy, here we go. Pure Flash Pulverize. There's a knockup coming in. The exhaust going down, though. Can they catch anybody? Pilot getting low. There's a flash from Watch. Can they get the kill? One more auto might do it. Maybe two more autos. Pilot, they dive in. Pure goes bloodthirsty. Oh, the Janna shield saves him, though. And now Chaser is here, and Pure's in a lot of trouble. Oh, no. When bloodthirsty goes wrong. And first blood taken by Pilot. Whoops.
Oh, that went south really fast. So Pure thought he could get that kill. Obviously, it was so close, but the cooldown on the Janna shield coming up in just the nick of time, and that allows Chaser time to get down there. I mean, it was a very patient gank from Watch. They really did sell that one. Kind of weird that Chaser was showing up on the map so much beforehand.
See, that's now Watch is going to have that happen, and he's going to be like, there, I'm never going to gank early again. See, guys, you see what happens? I was right all along. Don't gank early. It was it was so close, though. It was almost very good.
Yeah, and they had the kill pressure for sure, obviously, when you have the Alistar Rek'Sai in that bottom lane. The Kog'Maw going to have a few issues in the early game, and the Flash pulled to set it up looked like everything was going to go smoothly, but they also hadn't been back to buy yet, so OQ just didn't have very much damage.
Yeah. Comes back to lane with a BF sword. Pilot, though, coming back with a longsword and a Sheen, so he's going to be able to do quite a few chunks of damage now.
That's incredibly annoying for Tristana, too.
Yeah, it's very early Sheen. Well, the Sheen plus the longsword, especially at this point in the game, is going to be annoying to deal with.
Yeah, about the same cost as the BF sword, but
yeah.
Has the boots, and that's
very
good for the in-and-out trading that he's going to do with that Bioarcane Barrage.
Makes it harder for future ganks to work, too. In the meantime, they'll just have to defend relatively under their turret for a while anyway. But Pilot off with a pretty good start. The funny thing is he's still a little bit behind in CS, though.
Well, I mean, he's pretty much tied now that the last minion of that wave has evened up.
Yeah, you just think the poking would be able to do a little bit more.
Well, the poking really going to start to hurt now that he's nearly six. He's going to hit very soon. And that's where this is.
Oh boy, here comes Watch.
Watch is coming back. Now, they have a pink ward tribe. They know exactly where Watch is. They saw him go by on that ward, I believe.
Yeah, Chaser's already on his way, so Jhin'Air really seems like they have a pretty good feel about what's going on here.
This is the first time we've seen Nunu in a long time, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
He just hasn't been played in Korea in quite some time, even though he's still a perfectly fine pick. I mean, Nunu, I just feel like Nunu is one of those junglers that's just always viable, pretty much.
He is. Oh, and Najin actually going for an early dragon, sneaking that one in. And can they get it? Looks like they probably can. Yeah, Chase is going to put a ward down, but it's too late to come in and try something. And so Najin able to grab that first dragon of the game.
Yep, GBM on the recall, so there just wasn't much that Jhin'Air could do to stop that. And OQ is still able to push the wave very effectively with the explosive shot. And that means that just a totally free dragon for Najin.
Not bad.
I mean, Jhin'Air is not going to be too terribly worried about that. It doesn't actually make that big of a difference at this point in the game.
Yeah, just a nice little victory for Najin. They were able to come out ahead in Dragon's last game. And already ahead this game as well. So meanwhile, in the mid lane, things going fairly evenly between GBM and Goom. GBM opting for a couple upgrades before picking up any new items besides an extra Doran's ring and some boots.
Yeah, a bit interesting, but not too far from standard. Some players do like to get that second upgrade if they feel like they have enough mana.
Well, with all the Sand Soldiers, I suppose it wouldn't be too surprising if he got the Q upgrade earlier just to have a little bit extra sustain, you know?
Yeah, just, well, not sustain, but block some of the damage in the trades. Yeah.
Right, right.
Well, Trace having some trouble up here. Chaser actually has to back off. Raptor buff will get triggered, but he just wants to go do the blue. So Chaser not actually getting too terribly many deep wards down. But look at the pink wards on the side of Jhin'Air right now. They have so many pink wards just defensively lined up around that dragon pit, making sure that Watch can't get in behind the Kog'Maw and really punish them with more gangs. This is where it starts to really hurt for the Tristana.
Pilot's starting to do some pretty serious damage. Pure helps. Pure helps with the damage mitigation, but ooh, man. They've got a Warden that brush, so that's not a good place to hide for OQ and Pure. Yep, they figure it out. Like, hey, that was a little bit too easy.
Too accurate on those living artillery.
Suspiciously accurate. Watch able to take out one of those pink wards.
Pretty slow early game so far.
Pretty much. The even game overall. Similar to what we saw last time. Not a lot of action early on. A lot of farming. Chaser's going to see Watch. Watch is going to stick around and be annoying. Chaser can just go ahead and eat the big raptor. Oh, it's a battle.
He
gets
a
big raptor. He can eat it, though. He can consume it. And he does.
Got the help from GBM he needed.
Yep.
We got the big spike.
That's right.
The consume. Take it away, so...
Well, Duke about to go Meganar, and so Trace really can't stick around to harass or anything like that.
Yeah, Duke going for the Hex Drinker first. He doesn't have very many tanky stats for... See what he gets before this next dragon comes back, because if Trace can get a glory before Duke can actually complete a tank item, they could... Jhin'Air could be in a very good place.
Yeah.
Jeez, that's so annoying. And Pilot not even hitting that Trinity Force yet, so he will be arriving at that item in just a couple of minutes. About the time the dragon spawns, and that should be
a timing.
Very nice timing for Jhin'Air.
Yeah. A Nunu coming down to maybe clear out a ward or two. Perhaps make a play. They might try to cut off Chaser. Okay, yeah, Chaser not committing. Seeing Watch and Goon come down in the lane. And he's still standing in a ward, too. The warding from Najin has been very good both games so far.
Yeah, definitely looking stronger.
Yeah.
Than it did previously, and getting so many deep wards in, Rek'Sai's just simply not afraid of this Nunu. And why would you be? Finding Nunu in his jungle isn't that threatening. Nunu, on the other hand, Chaser needs to operate and get some deeper wards on his own. That early Sight Stone hasn't done him too many favors.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised that he hasn't been doing as much as far as going into his opponent's jungle and taking jungle camps goes. I mean, it kind of takes what's annoying about Nunu and then just not using it.
Well, part of it is that, for the most part, Goon has had control over the mid lane. So there's that aspect of it for sure. And Chaser's been worried about clearing out those wards. But GBM has been very self-sufficient. You'll notice GBM going back to that upgraded yellow trinket that is, looks like Jhin'Air wants to be doing that style of play this game. Pilot going to be holding on to the yellow trinket for now. So we could be going back to the normal upgraded ward totem strategy that Jhin'Air likes to run with their kiting comps.
Wow, and Jhin'Air actually able to get a pretty good angle down in this bot lane, poking out Pure a bit, forcing OQ to hop over the wall and come around the long way.
Now the Trinity Force should be done right now, 40 seconds before the dragon. That's why they wanted to get this recall timing in, but...
Yeah, they're going back.
I mean, they're going to lose their bottom tier 1 for the recall, more than likely. Oh, and they stopped it. Najin actually delayed the port.
Yeah, and that might
mean
no Trinity Force for
they
dragon.
Walked up and delayed the port. That was very smart of OQ and Pure, because now that means they may get a free dragon. Chaser doesn't have time to go back and finish his Cinder Hulk either, and Watch just use the Void Rush down to the bottom side of the map. So that was a great timing from Najin. So you get the Trinity Force, but Pilot is just not going to be there.
Well, OQ's recalling too, so it doesn't look like he's going to be around anytime soon. So this may actually give the opportunity back over to Jhin'Air.
I'm really surprised GBM also recalled. Najin could just do this. And OQ actually went back, like you were saying. Sorry. Yeah, that's odd. Odd recall timings. Najin seemed like they had set up a very good priority on that.
It just seems like Jhin'Air is not too concerned about these first two dragons right now. They didn't really stop Najin from getting a lot of wards down as well. They're going to let them take the pink ward. So Najin should still be able to take this dragon. There's one ward in the pit, but we'll see how much that actually matters.
That's enough to see, to get the information they need that they're doing it. Trace is just going to go ahead and take the Gromp and then recall. But Very odd from Najin, because there was a timing there where they could have just taken the dragon, and it all signs pointed to that they just wanted, they had set up a free dragon for themselves, and then OQ took a little bit of damage, but he still could have done it.
Yeah, now Jhin'Erik gets in with a lot of wards of their own. It looks like we might have a little bit of a fight here if Najin decides to contest this. We'll see. Oh, Duke's Meganar actually just occurred too, so if Jhin'Erik notices this, it might not be a bad timing to go in on it.
Well, they have to push out, and that's the problem, is that they're having such a hard time pushing in the bottom lane.
I see.
And OQ and Pure are again being very annoying with their pressure, just like they were last game, and preventing Jhin'Erik from having a lot of options.
All right, well, Rift Scuttler taken by Jhin'Erik. So I've got that Speed Shrine as well, but OQ already pushing down the bot lane again.
Pure going back. So really, I guess nobody's going to take this because nobody wants the dragon.
Nobody wants. The dragon is unloved and unwanted. Poor dragon. Actually, the dragon's okay because it means he lives. So that's nice.
Yeah, because love in League of Legends is death.
Love is being ignored in League of Legends. Love is being left alone. That sounds like a very emo song somebody wrote at one point.
Love is being left alone.
Love is being left alone. My parents just don't understand me.
Careful, that's our audience, Stella.
Oh, whoops. I'm sorry. Yeah, I agree. Your parents just don't understand you. They don't understand your love for League of Legends and especially OGN champions. But I do. So does Monty. And we're here for you 100%.
All the time, 4 days a week.
Yep, that's right. Saved it. Nailed it. Well, the battle over Dragon Vision continues, and Jhin'Erik maybe with a slight lead in that regard, but Najin's going to walk right up and get it right back as this shrine ends. There goes the Rift Scuttler.
Well,
he's
OQ's,
got a terrifying face.
OQ's pressure has really made it so that Chaser constantly has to walk into the bottom side to get anything done on this team, because he has to move that minion wave away from the tower over and over and over again.
It's kind of like a non-stop tug of war almost.
Yes, it is.
Only an opposite of a tug of war, like a push of war.
Doesn't sound quite as good as tug, does it?
Shove of war.
Shove of war.
There you go. It's still a bit awkward.
I wonder if anyone is ever going to do this dragon dive.
I don't know. It's kind of a weird situation. We don't usually see stuff like this happen, you know? Where neither team can gain a definitive edge. But look at this. Jhin'Erik doing a ton of damage to this turret after OQ decides to recall, and they're just going to get it. Wow.
Yep. And that's the danger, is that if you have a Nunu, one of the best ways to play him is just to walk into a lane and just start autoing a tower with Blood Boil. Because you can punish recall timings extremely hard if you do that, as we just saw. Now, they may lose their tower for it in return. They're trying to get the red buff at the moment onto Oak, or onto Pilot.
Yeah, well, the turret's going to take a bit of damage, but Trace is going to be able to keep it alive for now anyway. And the bottom lane actually taking some decent damage as well.
Yep, there is a Janna shield, though.
Yeah, preventing some of it anyway. Well, all the wards near Dragon belong to Najin now. For the moment, anyway.
Wow, another forced recall from Trace. So Duke, and the chip damage is coming in. I mean, Najin is making very slow headway.
Yeah, well, there's the turret going down. Duke able to win that 1v1.
Well, they had the more dominant matchups in terms of pressure in their solo lanes this game. Of course, there's not really much Maokai can do against the ranged harassment from Gnar.
True. And so, at this point, that bottom lane certainly under threat as well, too.
At least they have a little bit more wiggle room to press forward and buy more time for the recall.
Yeah.
And Jhin'Erik is going to be perfectly fine in the late game. They have extremely good scaling, and a Blood Boil Kog'Maw is not something that Najin's going to be able to easily cope with.
Yeah, so possibly that first two dragons not too important. Duke taking a lot of damage, but then turning it right around onto Trace here. Duke, there we go, Arcane Smash. No Meganar for Duke for a while. Both top laners getting a bit low before breaking it off.
Yeah, Trace, though, holding on for a little bit longer. Got to be a slightly more wary of Duke now.
Yeah, well, now the Meganar is going to be an issue again, so no more 1v1ing. Najin able to get the Rift Scuttler this time.
This is so long without a dragon being taken.
Yeah. I mean, the first dragon was taken very early by Najin, and now it's been such a long break. Jhenair finally going for it. Goong is there to try to poke, though, and he's getting a lot of good poking onto Chaser. This could be rough for Jhenair. Here we go. They're going to go in. Nice knock up. Che comes in, pushes Najin back a little bit. Can Jhenair fight this? GBM in the middle of everything. He's getting very, very low, but gets some decent damage on a kill for Kog'Maw. Pilot with good positioning. Dragon still with a lot of health, though. Here getting very, very low. Summoner heal not quite used yet. Used by Goong, keeping him alive. OQ still has his and his flash.
They're trying to wait for Goong's rage bar. Now, Najin wants to go take the mid lane tower, looks like.
Yeah, will they give up the dragon for it? I mean, they would, but...
I mean, they have to make that decision. OQ just going to clear it up. They think they can wait long enough.
Wow, and Jhenair swinging around the back. They're going to try to save the turret, but it's too late. No, they're just backing away.
Tristana's going to kill this with the bomb. That's it.
Wow, and now they're going to give the dragon over to Najin as well, too. So Najin gets a turret, gets a dragon. Jhenair just kind of running around without accomplishing much at all.
Wow, you really have to wonder how much shot calling Captain Jack provides for this team, because they were very indecisive. GBM was mispositioned at the start of that fight. And even though they had a good... The rest of them could have kited that out very nicely, and Trace got there with a nice teleport so he could provide that front line. GBM just died nearly instantly.
Oh, OQ taking some decent damage. He might go down here. Whirlwind. Ah, Watch comes to save the day, and he'll be able to make it out. A little bit too far to chase for Pilot and Che.
Wow, Duke completing Maw of Malmortius.
Wow.
Just really wants to harass and get the 1v1 split going against this Maokai.
Well, this is also the... Well, I believe this is also the patch as well, too, where they took away the slow and the reduction in damage to the base turrets. Was that 5.13?
Base turrets. Yes, yes.
The base turrets. Yeah, it is 5.12, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
See, it's hard for a caster when you, like, read multiple patch notes and you're like, ah, oh, which is that one
That's
from?
That's why you shouldn't read them until they come to the tournament, because otherwise you get confused.
I get so excited when new patch notes come out, and then I read them, and then I, like, get them mixed up. Yeah. You warned me. I did it anyway. Oh, well. But yeah, the split push is a little bit stronger in 5.12. In general.
Indeed. Well, Jhenair has to do something here.
Well, catching OQ would be something, but it's not going to be an easy something. Well, okay, poke from Pilot.
Weird that Najin has an early lock it this game when it took them so long to get it last game.
Right. I mean, I guess there is a lot of AP coming in from the mid and the AD carry, but
yeah,
still.
The percent health on Bioarcane Barrage is magic damage, so the Aegis is effective against Kog'Maw, but it's still odd, still a bit strange.
Maybe they realized the error of their ways last game. They're just like, you know what? We need that locket much faster in game two. Monty was right.
Yeah, weird that Trace is building for magic resist also, getting that cowl. When he's had to deal with this Maw of Malmortius / Hex Drinker and just a lot of auto attack damage from Duke, he really needs a... Okay, goodbye. This is what Tristana does.
Yep.
He really needs a Frozen Heart this game, and he needs it fast, because Frozen Heart is actually insanely efficient against Najin's composition. Because it shuts down both of their carries, because both carries are attack speed reliant.
Maokai looked so frantic when he was running towards the bot lane. He's like, no, my turret! But it was already too late. And he shouldn't run, because all those flaming coals in the brazier hanging behind his head could go off at any time. Could spill into the cracks of his bark. That doesn't sound comfortable, does it?
I mean, Duke's eating a helicopter. That doesn't seem very comfortable either.
Yeah, but it looks like he can handle it. I don't know if Trace can handle fire. Apparently, he can't handle boomerangs either.
Repeated boomeranging.
Boomeranging. Is that what you, that's what you say when you're a boomerang aficionado? I think I'll just go do some boomeranging this afternoon.
They probably have some dumb slang word like ranging for it.
You know, Papa Smithy told me that in Australia they call AC/DC Akadaka.
Yeah.
You Australians. That is adorable.
Oh, wow.
Whoa,
nice
Trace pushed out by Goon. Goon taking a lot of damage, though. Trace getting poked, but very tanky. Should be okay. Jhenair looking for some kills. OQ pushing back Chaser. He's going to flash the wall anyway. Flash snowball. He's going to go in onto OQ. There's the ultimate. Gets pushed out. The whirlwind knocks him up anyway. They'll teleport coming in for Najin now. Duke coming in. Oh, he misses his ult. Would have just pushed him away anyway. Doesn't look like Jhenair can get any kills out of this unless Najin decides to go deep with a re-engage, but it was a bit of an awkward fight. Nobody dies. Okay.
Jhenair is trying way too hard to engage this series. I mean, once Trace uses his W, you don't have any more engage.
Uh-oh. There you go. Now Trace, they catch watch.
That's what happens when you actually have engage for Jhenair, when you're not trying to flash snowball and then ultimate to catch an AD carry. I don't know what it is with Jhenair today. Maybe they've been practicing to play more aggressively, but
maybe
it's been pretty awkward.
Well, I mean, whenever you're trying something new, it's never going to be perfect, I suppose, but at least they caught watch. Not that that's really hard to do, but at least they caught watch. Oh, nice deny on the recall from GBM. A little bit annoying for Goon to deal with. I guess now we know the answer to the question, who watches the watch, man?
Who?
Jhenair. All of them. They found him.
I think they were better at watching the Watchman last best of three with Rek'Sai.
Yeah, I think so too. Doing a little bit of watching this time.
I would actually say that Jhenair's warding has been fairly underwhelming this series so far. So I don't think they're doing a great job of watching the Watchman.
Well, Watch is actually being a good Watchman this time.
He is.
Yeah. Ward-wise, not getting caught-wise. Was that a double negative?
Not getting caught wise?
Not getting caught.
Yes.
That is
a double negative.
Oh, well. Sir, those are worth double the points on English exams, right? I'm pretty sure that's why they call it a double negative.
Well, that explains a lot about your educational background. I just learned so much about you, Dylan.
Negative, as in a golf score. It's better when it's lower.
All right, here we go.
Dragon being taken by Najin. Jhenair wants to stop it. They're going to go in onto Pure, keeping him out for now. Looks like the Dragon will still go to Najin. And Jhenair, they just can't find a way to really engage with this.
Well, they're not running a comp that has a lot of engage. Just
not
like
really.
Last game, you have to get to the Dragon first. If you're playing a composition like this so you can force the fight. Najin has had just carte blanche because they have the better warding. They're getting the objectives first, and Jhenair wants to kite. And both times, in both games, they've had really big issues with this. So Jhenair has to do something drastic. They have to start baiting Baron. They have to threaten Baron now. And they can do it because they have a Kog'Maw with Blade, and they have the Nunu. But they have to commit to getting this Baron early if they want to win this game.
Yeah. Well, Najin has completely dominated the Dragons in this match so far. 6-2 overall.
This is smart from Jhenair. Just take the topside tower while you can get it with the blood-boiled Nunu, and then push up the wave and start to get the wards down on Baron.
Trying to hold and push the mid lane is Najin in the meantime as all of Jhenair goes up top. Bottom lane is pushing in favor of Jhenair for the moment, though. So Najin's going to have to send somebody to deal with that. Probably just OQ. He gets his red buff, too. Or gets the enemy red buff, rather.
Yeah, Najin in such a good position just to win this game by dragon stacking now, because Najin's been incredibly underwhelming when it comes... it's fine if they want to engage, but they have to pick a composition that can actually do it effectively. Mm-hmm. Neither this game nor last game has that been the purpose of their comp.
Hmm. Well, that turret's actually going to take some pretty decent damage. Looks like Watch is going down there now, but that turret will probably lose a bit of its life.
Yeah, let's see if they actually have the ward clear here.
They could just, they might be able to just go for they this Baron
they
if they
just
see
do
Watch.
It.
Yeah, I was going to say, well, Chaser recalling, but yeah, I feel like that was an opportunity to just go for Baron.
I think you, Oki is walking back right there. They were worried because there was a minion wave in mid. But
yeah, I guess.
Watch also has his ult, obviously. He can get across
very
quickly. But
oh, he does have turrets behind the Baron pit too. I didn't notice that.
Yeah, so it is dangerous, but all the same, there has to be some sort of pressure that goes down onto the Baron, because otherwise Najin is just going to sit there and then stack up dragons over and over and over again until they hit five.
Well, so far so good for Najin as far as doing that goes.
Yeah, they're in a very comfortable position right now. All they have to do is be patient.
Yeah, just kind of wait for the next dragon, fend off the pushes from Jhin'er, and just keep doing what they're doing.
Jhin'er needs more pink wards now. They have a couple in their inventory. And Najin, all they have to do is use Duke here with his very annoying Law of Malmortius to keep on moving with Trace. Regisglory used right there.
Well, Trace is tanky enough to push back the minion wave a bit anyway.
Yeah.
Man, there's just so much pushing power on Najin between Azir, Tristana.
Yeah, and the Siege. I mean, we haven't talked about that. Tristana,
yeah.
Azir, you can't let these champions get it within range of your towers for even one wave, because that tower will go down.
Yeah.
Well, there is just a ridiculous amount of turret damage from Najin.
At this point, too, it seems like if Najin gets Baron, it's just kind of lights out.
Oh, yeah. It'll be a very easy game for them. They were looking to see if maybe they could sneak a Baron using Sand Soldiers over the wall, as well as having Tristana jump in there, but they're seen by a ward, so they instead have to abandon that plan. But Najin definitely has a very strong red side Baron composition, because Azir is just going to be able to stand behind the wall and poke it,
yeah,
while everyone else can just hop the wall.
Very true. Finally some deep wards going down for Jhin'er. Shay dropping a few, but it's not a lot of vision yet.
They finally have... I mean, you'd think that with two upgraded ward totems and with two sight stones, Jhin'er would have some more coverage.
That's a good point.
They don't. Kind of strange. GBM going for the Lich Bane, so we'll be kiting heavily with the Victor, if in fact he doesn't get caught in the middle of the team again.
You know, Che wants to save his ward. And we'll see if he can do it. Saved up that whirlwind for Goong, and that may actually... Nope. Nope, yeah, he'll still get it. All right.
It's okay, really he has a sidestone. Just drop another charge.
Why not?
It's not a big deal.
Dragon up in less than a minute now, and this is what Najin's been waiting for. So they do want to get a bit more vision around Dragon. Now, if you're Jhin'er, I mean, you're stuck behind a rock in a hard place, because you can't really go for Baron and just let them have the fourth Dragon. That puts too much pressure on you, too.
Yeah, unless you could get an absolutely massive gold lead out of the Baron, which doesn't seem that likely, considering they're already playing at a deficit. So Jhin'er, they have to get into the river and deny Najin the chance to get into the choke point.
Well, they're doing it so far for the moment, but now pulling back just because Najin is going to push up the mid lane.
Two frozen hearts. Kog'Maw has his armor penetration. This is a very good time for Jhin'er to fight, as long as they do it properly this time.
They've got a good amount of power.
So Najin going to try and fall back to the Baron trick to threaten that objective, because if you're Najin, you'll gladly trade a dragon for this Baron.
That's true. And Pilot going for the dragon anyway. They're going to try to take it with just him. And meanwhile, Jhin'er's going to try to prevent the Baron as much as they can. Najin knows what's up now, I think. They will get the dragon, though. So Jhin'er scores their first dragon of the game. Here comes the chase from Najin. Can they actually catch anybody, though? It doesn't look like it. Does this leave them any opportunities for Baron here, though? Looks like it might.
They're going to be seen walking over there.
Yeah.
It's probably just going to be a bait. Not sure you can really all in on this. Everyone from Jhin'er is still around the mid lane. There's the orb coming down.
Yep.
Let's see that they're not doing it. That's going to force them to back off. So Jhin'er finally getting the priority on the dragon. They played that out very nicely, of course. Kog'Maw able to lifesteal tank with the Blade of the Ruined King just fine. So good call from Jenner. And Najin, smartly, I think, not attacking into that.
Yeah, well, it's still kind of Najin's game at this point. You know, they can give up that dragon without too much issue. They can't give Jenner a good team fight right now, though. And they don't.
Nope.
They do, however, put pressure on the top lane anyway, and they're going to have to send someone bottom. But more passive game incoming, it looks like.
Well, Jhenair doesn't have tend to have a lot of kills in their games,
yep.
Generally speaking. They like to play a very safe, reserved style of League of Legends.
Which is funny, because they actually did have a lot of kills in their last match versus Najin. That's pretty much how they won their games.
Yeah. But generally speaking.
Yeah, usually they do keep it a little bit more tactical, unfortunately. OQ critting those minions for 842 damage. Wow.
Oh boy.
OQ. Pink Ward gone. I feel bad for Butterfly Kog'Maw, because he like runs a couple steps and then tries to like fly and he just can't do it. He's like, what was the point of my metamorphosis after all?
He was deformed, because he's still like half larva too, you know?
Yeah, it's true. Something went really wrong there.
Poor Kog'Maw.
Yeah.
All he wanted to be was a beautiful butterfly.
Nope, can't even be that.
Instead, he's a really deformed.
Now he's a terrifying abomination. But he does do pretty decent siege damage, so he's got that going.
He's really strong.
Yeah.
And he has Acid Spit.
Yeah. And who doesn't want Acid Spit?
I wish I had Acid Spit.
That's how you handle those aggressive fans. Just spit acid at them. People wonder why so many fans come back from OGN with acid burns.
I wish I had it. I don't actually have it. Sadly.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad, too.
And I would never use it on the fans.
Okay. Good to know.
I would only use it for good.
That's right. As most people with acid spit would. Would you call yourself, like, the reptile or something?
I mean, reptiles don't have acid spit.
Yeah, Mortal Kombat reptile did.
So I'm going to
checkmate.
I'm going to name myself after a fictional character who named himself after a... kind of animal? No, Dylan, it's too convoluted.
It's got so many layers. It's so deep.
It's not deep. It's very simple. And, well, please never write a book, because your metaphors would be terrible.
You could name yourself Dilophosaurus Man from the acid-spitting dinosaur in Michael Crichton's Jurassic Park.
I don't think those dinosaurs actually spit acid. I don't even know how you could possibly know that.
That may have been a writer's liberty. Yeah. That's right. Well, it's going to be a Baron from Najin. They're just going to go for it, and they can kill it so fast. Oh, boy. Jhenair teleporting in, though. Are they going to finish off? Trace coming from the side. No equalizer there. He's going to go in. Baron taken by Najin. Pure getting a little bit low. Pilot laying down the damage. OQ nearly gets taken out, but escapes. And Jhenair chasing, though. Do they have the ability to actually pick him off? GBM looking to do damage over the wall, but he just can't do enough. They may get Pure. They will get Pure. Pilot with a kill there. But Najin gets the Baron, and that's where the real threat comes from here.
I feel like GBM, if he had flashed that wall at the Baron pit, he actually could have had a big follow-up. He's got
maybe
the Lich Bane, and he has the speed from the Q, and he has a full health.
Well, this gives Jhenair an opportunity to take a turret here, which is not bad when your opponents have just gotten Baron.
Yeah, still lost the Baron, though, and that Baron buff is going to be up for the next team fight, and Pure's going to be back and ready to go by then. So
by the next team fight, you mean when Dragon comes up in the minute 20?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
because that would be fourth Dragon again, which Najin can't be allowed to have if you're Jhenair.
Yeah, very, very dangerous situation. But Najin actually gets the Baron right there. Jhenair just a little bit too slow, but both of these compositions can do the Baron extremely fast. You have the Azir Tristana on the one side. Of course, you have that rapid fire on Tristana to make that Baron really go down. Tristana has a high amount of single target damage, and then the Kog'Maw Nunu on the other side. But Jhenair just a step behind, and even though they win the team fight, they can't actually pick up enough kills to justify the loss. And now they're not in position around this dragon. Najin gets the edge. They get into the river first.
Yeah, and now Jhenair on the defensive again. They've got good wave clear, too. But they need to worry about this dragon more than anything else right now. Watch just pushing that bot lane, just adding more pressure on.
And there's no more TP. Trace had to use it to get out of the situation where Najin had set up that large wave in the bottom side well in advance. Yep. Fortunately...
Oh, Righteous Glory activated. They're going to try to go in on this. They can't quite find a fight, but they don't. Well, they tried to find the positioning in the river, too, but they couldn't get that either.
But they actually just backed off right into the mid lane. They don't have Righteous Glory now.
Dragon started by Najin right now. And here we go. Trace wading into the enemy team, now wading away from the enemy team, now wading back into the enemy team. Meanwhile, Dragon goes down. Najin takes their fourth. Trace taking a lot of damage without accomplishing a lot, and Jhin'Air just has to back off again.
Well, he's the only one who could do any kind of engage with this Janna and Nunu also on his team. Without the Righteous Glory to speed everybody else up, there's not a lot that this Maokai can do, especially since he has to go through an Alistar, Rek'Sai, Gnar frontline, and Azir too. He can't just... If he ults into the backline, he's just going to get knocked away by an Azir ult. Mm-hmm. So it's really hard for Jhin'Air to actually force the fights they want, unless they can convince Najin that Najin is the team that wants to engage, which Najin is, to their credit, intelligently not doing. They're just taking an objective and piecing out every time.
Yep. I mean,
this is the right way to play against Jhin'Air's compositions. They've been doing it both games.
Yep. And they're going to scale
the objective,
just fine. So
just leave.
Why couldn't my solo queue team know that? Just take the objective and leave. They usually just lose an objective and then leave the game.
Well, it was a form of leaving.
They do the leave part. They just don't do the right leaving.
It's like one of those cursed monkey paw wishes where you're like, I wish that my solo queue team would just take an objective and leave. And your next solo queue game, you're like, yes, we got the Baron. And then all your allies disconnect.
You're like, oh, no, why did I make an account on you, West? Oh, and by that cursed monkey paw. Oh, well. Najin gets it, though. Playing a very tactical game. And they've got that threat of a fifth dragon now. Interestingly enough, still 43 minutes in, only three turrets down on each side. It's been a bit slow.
It certainly has been. And neither of these teams, I think, really committing or trying to take as many advantages as they could. And instead just happy to keep on farming up. And if you're Jhin'Air, there is logic to that. You want this Blood Boil Kog'Maw in the six item range here for sure. And Pilot's gotten pretty fed.
Yeah, it's still a big threat. I mean, it's like the second game in a row where Jhin'Air is in the position where if they win a big team fight, they can just steamroll their way in for an inhibitor and maybe the win at this point.
Well, Najin is so scary. I mean, if they win a team fight, this game is instantly over with Tristana and Azir. Even though there are only three turrets, I'm pretty sure Najin during the death timers could clear out all the tier 2 inhibitor and base Nexus turrets and just end it.
It kind of goes both ways, though, doesn't it? You know, if Jhin'Air can somehow win a really clean team fight, they can do the same thing. But right now, GBM coming in from behind, drops that Chaos Storm. There it is, big engage. Emperor's Divide comes in, and now Najin re-engages. Duke trying to come in, but still doesn't have Gnar quite yet. Trace all over OQ, though, but OQ jumps out, doesn't take a lot of damage. But Jhin'Air, they are winning this fight. Can OQ make a difference here? GBM comes back in, a lot of damage, and now the poke from Pilot doing a lot of work. This is kind of what we were talking about. Chaser coming in. Can he get anybody? No, doesn't get in range for a snowball. There goes Duke. Gets taken out by GBM. GBM with a huge amount of plays here. He might get Watch as well, too. Doesn't quite get him. Takes some turret hits, but can Jhin'Air take anything significant out of this? Uh-oh, here comes OQ. Ward's coming down. There's some poke. GBM doing a great job with the ward over the wall to zone out OQ. OQ, if he had gotten taken out, that game might have been over.
Well, GBM solves the lack of engage problem with a Victor flank. Now, Najin didn't have any wards in that brush. It was pink warded by Jhin'Air, but they could see the front line. So no one honestly expects Victor to come out and full combo you from a flank.
Seriously.
I mean, that was a surprise play from GBM, and that carried a lot of risk, but that is a testament to how bad this team is at engaging, that they even have to resort to ridiculous tactics like that. It was effective. Will Najin allow that to happen again? Probably not. And they lost two turrets off of it, but not much else. It just pretty much evened up the gold, which wasn't that big of a factor this late in the game anyway.
Pilot did pick up the Infinity Edge.
I mean, this is really...
Well,
look at GBM.
Oh, man.
What a great Chaos Storm combo just to eliminate Goon from the fight nearly instantly. And then he continues to put down a ludicrous amount of damage from the flank here. He plays this team fight beautifully.
Yeah. No kidding. Speaking of playing it beautifully, though, OQ does a great job of getting out and not getting taken down.
Yeah, they did have to chase Goon around a little bit, and GBM cleans it up that time, too, going after Duke and then almost killing Watch.
Yep.
Trying to use that Lich Bane and Q speed to catch up. But you know what? They don't actually deny the possible fifth dragon that's going to be coming in a minute. They don't take the Baron, so it's not that great of a win, honestly, for Jhin'Air, in spite of how good that teamfight was.
All right, Righteous Glory popped, and they're going to go in onto Duke, it looks like, for the moment, anyway.
Yeah, but he had to use the W on the Banshee's Veil, so they can't actually lock him down. Jhin'Air, their solution is just going to be to try and get a siege down onto the mid lane and threaten. They have a Lich Bane in the Kog'Maw, so a lot of Sheen procs. This turret can just die.
It's not the worst idea. The turret taking a lot of damage, but they're worried about the engage from Gnar. The Gnar bar is filling up pretty rapidly. Yeah, about to go Mega Gnar, and that's a little bit too much of a threat for Jhin'Air. Not to mention everybody else on Najin.
Yeah, this game started slow, but it's been really good in the last few minutes.
Yeah. Well, Jhin'Air has been behind the entire time, but they've managed to keep things close enough that the threat of a teamfight win is very clearly still there. Dragon coming up, and we'll see if Najin wants to take the Baron for it. They can.
Najin gets a huge advantage, right? They either get the Baron or they get five dragons.
Pilot is a bit late to this fight here. Baron going down looks like it's going to be taken by Najin. They will get it. Meanwhile, the fight is happening. Here comes GBM laying down a lot of damage. There goes Duke. They have to back away, though. This could be bad for Najin. Pure caught. Going to go back in. Gets a nice headbutt pulverized, but gets taken out. It allows the rest of the team to escape with the Baron buff. But now Jhin'Air has a chance to maybe push in and take this inhibitor. They don't even care about the dragon because it's not as important.
Oh, that is your turret is low, and that's going to go down. Yeah, they do want the inhibitor first, definitely.
That turret's really low, too.
Yeah, it's very low, and they have two Sheens.
Wow, they're going to get an inhibitor off of this. So Najin gets the Baron, but Jhin'Air gets the inhibitor, and they're probably going to get the dragon on the way out, too.
That is a huge wave. That tier 2 turret is definitely gone, but that's a worthy sacrifice. Jhin'Air manages to win that team fight, and you can see how much damage this Kog'Maw is doing now that he's six items.
Well, GBM,
he just shredded Duke in the front line. There wasn't anything this Gnar could really do against the Kog'Maw, even though he had tons of items to try and deal with it.
So now just probably going to give up their tier 2
mid. You know, he gets blown up. GBM is also doing a ridiculous amount of damage, as you can see. And landed that combo, just dropped it right on Duke's head before he could transform. Duke goes down while his team finishes up the Baron, and they take out Pure also.
So Jhin'Air actually one turret ahead at this point after taking out the inhibitor. While we were watching the replay, OQ came up and killed the tier 2 inhibitor, killed the tier 2 turret in mid.
I didn't even notice Che's item build this game.
Zeke's
Herald Ardent Sensor.
Is that the first Ardent Sensor we've ever seen? It might be. Here in Korea, I think it very well could be.
It's definitely the first serious Ardent Sensor we've seen.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Maybe
now, it was changed. It was changed a little bit ago where it was actually made probably quite a bit better. But
still an
item. This is a composition that is just built around this Kog'Maw doing as much damage as possible.
Yeah, well, Ardent Sensor plus Zeke's on a Kog'Maw.
And plus Blood Boil. I mean, this is about as scary as it gets.
Yeah.
And I don't know if Najin's going to be able to get into the back line to kill the Kog'Maw. Najin's best chance is just to wait this one out and just continue to try and get Barons and Fifth Dragon stacks.
This is kind of like turning into one of those videos where it's like, how much can we make a Kog'Maw do? How much damage can we get him to do? Well, you get Zeke's Herald, Argent Sensor, bunch of items on Kog'Maw. You play the game out to 50 minutes. That's a scary Kog'Maw. And it is 9-1 in kills for Jhin'Air now. This is interesting. They've been able to find the opportunities.
Well,
a close game, though.
Why we're at an impasse is because Jhin'Air can't engage, right? And Najin can't dive them. without that fifth dragon, because Jhin'Air is so good at kiting, and that Kog'Maw will mess them up if they try and dive.
Right.
So can't dive. They just have to. Najin is forced to continue to play around objectives instead of actually finishing the game.
It's really a game of vision at this point. Whoever gets caught out is going to probably lose.
It's quite deadly in that regard, yes. And, of course, vision hard to come by this late in the game when you don't have any item slots for wards. Scimitar done for Pilot now. He's about maximum terror levels.
Yep. Until he finishes his blade. Oh, they're chasing Chaser. This is a bit awkward. And, oh boy, if they walk into a choke, they pop that Righteous Glory, but Najin was about a few pixels away from getting completely lit up in a choke point. Backed off just in time.
Yeah, if GBM had been there, it could have been problematic. But
yeah. So
they're still pushing this out. Now, it's so late in the game, these super minions don't really matter. Najin is still able to keep this wave nice and pressed forward.
True.
It's an interesting point.
Yeah, no one's going to do anything, though, until the next Dragon or Baron comes up. And actually, Dragon and Baron should be spawning at about the same time, because basically after the Baron was taken out, Jhin'Air took a minute to go take the inhibitor and then walk back to the Dragon. So the spawn should be probably within about 20 seconds of each other.
So you would think the fight's going to happen around Dragon then, because Jhin'Air can't let Najin have that fifth.
Well, I can't let him really have either. That's the issue. But Jhin'Air's going to have a lot of options into how they play it. They can push very aggressively up. They can threaten the inhibitor again, because it should be respawning at about that time. They can just send the Kog'Maw alone down there to take the Baron while the rest of the team tries to stop the Baron from, or the Dragon, while the rest of the team tries to stop the Baron from going down.
A little bit of a siege coming in from Jhin'Air now. They're going to try for this tier 2 in mid, or in bot lane. What game is this again? They're going to get it easily. It was already low health. There we go. 7-5, Jhin'Air.
Oh, yeah.
Pulling ahead in turrets a bit.
Yeah, they're within 8 seconds of each other. That is extremely close.
Well, as if this game needed more tension.
Everybody at 6 items. Thornmail for Watch now.
Yeah.
Guardian Angel for Duke.
Well, to be fair, there could be some ruby sightstones in there instead of regular sightstones.
Yeah, get it together.
Come on. Pilot trying to motivate the troops, inspiring everyone to go forth to victory.
Bored, got to toot the horn for battle.
Yep.
That is the least intimidating war music. It's not like in Mad Max where they have that guy on the truck with the guitar.
Dude. That's what I would have if I was going to battle. I'd have a dude hanging from the front of my truck with a guitar that shoots flame.
And a huge wall of speakers.
Yeah. That's cool. What music would you play from your wall of speakers with that guy?
I don't know. Like the shredding, just the general metal shredding that he does in Mad Max seems appropriate, right?
I'd blast out, "Don't Go Chasing Waterfalls" by TLC.
You truly know how to inspire the troops, Doa.
That's right. I just want them to stick to the rivers and the lakes that they're used to.
Why not My Heart Will Go On? That way you can make sure they're nice and sentimental by the time battle starts.
That's true.
You know that tin whistle part at the beginning? That really gets people, like, bloodthirsty.
Yeah. You could do sort of like a little motif where it's like a Leonardo DiCaprio hanging from the front of the speaker truck instead of the guy with the flamethrower guitar. Pretending he's sinking into the ice-cold Pacific Ocean.
Wow, Jhin'Air, so they take that. They use the 8-second timing window right there.
They get it.
They get it, so they're actually able to contest both. They could commit to that. That was smart.
Najin grouped up, though. This could go bad. They're going to get the Baron, but will they lose the fight? Here we go. Now trying to re-engage. Where's the engage from GBM? Duke comes in. Che pushes back. Duke a little bit. Watch goes in, gets taken down. Man, they destroyed him so fast, and now Jhin'Air has the edge. Once again, Baron not mattering in the teamfight. Goon pushing people away, taking a lot of damage from Pilot, though. Trace gets low, has to back away. Chaos Storm mitigated quite a bit. OQ somehow just not taking any damage from anything yet. Jhin'Air still chasing. And with Watch out of the way, they may catch them. GBM doing a lot of damage to Duke. Here comes Tracy, teleported behind everyone. Pure goes back, can't make a difference. OQ gets caught. There's the exhaust. Jhin'Air gets him. There's a double kill for Pilot. And this game looks to be over as Jhin'Air cleans up this team fight. GBM flashing ahead. for another cool double kill, and that is it. Wow, GBM, I guess that's why you put him in, huh?
Yeah, great Victor play from GBM this game. And Pilot is doing so much damage. I mean, he's ending this game 8-0-6 after that last team fight.
Crazy.
Watch stood no chance in the front line. I have never seen, I think, an AD carry melt tanks as fast as Pilot is right now.
Wow, well, they melted the Nexus fast, too. It is over. GG, and we are all tied up in one of the closest series we've probably seen all season.
Yeah, I mean, 14-1 in kills in favor of Jhin Air, but they can only win by maybe 1,000 gold here when the dust settles.
Yeah.
A lot of that's some farm differentials with Najin, and the fact that Najin was able to get so many Barons this game.
Importantly, though, in the end, 14-1 kills for Jhin Air, and those kills were used to take objectives, to get map position back again. So they found it.
And Pilot also had 100% kill contribution.
Wow.
That game.
That's amazing.
And so did Che, actually. So,
yeah.
Game.
Well, we will see if things are a little bit cleaner here as we go into game number three between Najin Empire and Jhin Air Green Wings. And Kog'Maw. Wow. Kog'Maw banned out against Pilot.
I really liked Jhin Air's draft and their reaction to what Najin threw at them in game one.
Yeah.
So, and now the Kog'Maw can be banned. Remember, Nidalee, Annie, and Rek'Sai were the bans last time Najin was on blue side.
Right. And Annie Gragas banned out again.
Yeah, same ban so far for Jhin Air that we saw in the first set. But now, for the first time, we're going to see fewer jungler bans this series, because remember that Najin has banned two junglers every game so far.
Yeah, well, still banning that Rek'Sai. Not wanting Chaser to get his hands on it. The Gragas is banned as well. So what will Jhin Air pick for their third ban here? A lot to choose from, actually.
Alistar.
Alistar it is.
And they're going to hope, I think, that Najin doesn't take Victor first.
And they will? They will, yeah.
So
I mean, Goong has played a good amount of Victor this season.
GBM also has a very large champion pool.
Yeah.
And the surprise here is that we haven't seen any of that Runeglaive Ezreal yet. No one's tried to play it. Of course, it is punishing right now in Korea. If you do have a low wave clear mid laner, teams are very good at abusing that. So taking away the Evelynn should be a very high priority for Jhin Air this game. Might be Chaser's first game on Eve so far this series. But
you know, the Nidalee is available, too. It's been banned out both other games against
no,
him.
No. You want to take the Evelynn and see what Watch does, because you're
right.
Putting Watch in a really difficult situation right now.
That is true. He'll probably just go with Lee Sin, but that's not a bad thing if you're Jhin Air.
Right, definitely. I think you 100% take the Evelynn
and the
just
is
put
great
Watch in a very uncomfortable situation. Yes, and I agree. Okay. I don't know about this. Yes, the Sivir is strong, but Pilot didn't have a very inspiring game on Sivir in game one. Okay, Evelynn Sivir is fine.
Okay. Yeah, Eve Sivir taken by Jhin Air. And, well, Echo's been nerfed pretty hard, so I don't think we're going to see that one.
No. Najin should take the Maokai here. That would make the most sense, and maybe Jhin Air has to go back to a mid-game composition with Rumble and Sivir at that stage, but...
Yep, thought so.
Yep, Lee Sin.
Lee Sin, they will
surprising.
Grab the Maokai, yeah. All right. Well, probably not going to take the Orianna here. But maybe the Ezreal. Yeah, we've been talking about this the entire time with the Runeglaive.
GBM is the exact player you want on a mid lane as two. Great with long range skill shots. He's played mid lane Ezreal in the past, AD.
Yeah.
This is definitely the style of pick that would work very well for GBM. As long as he doesn't get pushed in early, because of course that's the danger, is that it takes a while for the APS to ramp up and you have to take Smite, basically, but that would be interesting. GBM hasn't played Zed in a very long time, but he used to be a very good Zed player.
Yeah.
And it's good against the Victor.
I could go for the Orianna as well. What do you think
Ahri
about
also,
the Ahri?
Also
yeah.
Good.
Bad. Oh, Orianna. So a classic locked in for GBM.
He hasn't played Ahri in a really long time, though. Remember, For those of you who don't know,
yeah.
Gangbai Mom, when he came into the scene on CJ Frost, was an extremely good Ori player, but he didn't. He was Ori and Zed pretty much only.
And pretty much Ori out of Ori and Zed. He was mostly just known as the guy who was really good on Orianna, but couldn't really play much of anything else. And he's since become a much more developed mid laner, but going back to the Orianna for this game, and I guess if you pair it with Rumble's Equalizer, it's arguably good. Again, you know, I mean, if Chaser has a good flank with Eve as well, too, it could work.
Now we've been seeing a little bit more Ori here in Korea, generally,
yeah.
But still a bit of a rare pick. And OQ thinking about going for the Corki this game. No support up yet for Jhin Air. I wonder if they have some tricks in store. Yeah, Najin should probably just take the Nautilus right now, because Jhin Air probably would last pick that champion.
Oh, definitely. Che has been pretty much Nautilus Annie the entire season. Will go for the Thresh this time around, and he was a great Thresh player before. Maybe, I don't know, do you think you take the Janna here?
No.
I feel like the Thresh is a bit better.
Braum against Corki does have a strong laning phase, but I think the Thresh is the best. It sets up the pick potential and gives you more tools to engage with safely without having to, like, run in with your flash in with your ult or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And also does have that nice laning phase against Corki, because you can just block the Phosphorus Bomb and trade, or I mean the Thresh. Never mind, I was thinking about the Braum, but yeah, the Thresh is going to be fine too in this circumstance. I think we may see a lane swap this game. It's weird that we've had standard lanes in all of the matches so far.
Well, it's dangerous to do against OQ and Pure as well, which is, you know, what we've seen them get pushed in a lot. We haven't seen OQ and Pure really get a lot of kills in the bottom lane, though.
No, but they did take over game one in a huge way with that CS advantage.
That is true.
Corki not going to be the stronger laner in terms of Sivir versus Corki, though, so he's going to have less of a chance to really push for a lead. And otherwise, Jhin Air looks like they have a pretty standard composition. They are going to be reliant on Chaser to engage, but Chaser is really good at getting Evelynn flanks, so...
Oh, yeah.
That's not too much of a concern.
Some pretty huge wombo combos on the Jhin Air side if they're able to get the right positioning with it. And, you know, where they've struggled a lot today, too, has been in the Dragon department, and this team really addresses a lot of those problems.
Yeah, as long as they can group up Pop properly, as long as GBM's with the team, which he wasn't in some of the early Dragon fights last game.
Very true. Well, here we go. Third game. Who's going to take it? Najin versus Jhin Air. Let's find out. Here we go. Game number three, Najin Empire versus Jhin Air Green Wings. Crowd really getting into it now. It's been a while since we've had a series that has been this close, I feel.
Yeah, and three games. It's been a lot of 2-0s recently, so.
Yeah. Yes, it has. Well, we'll get one in our second match of the night. Don't worry.
Well,
that didn't
happen the last time SKT played Anarchy, so.
That is true. That is true.
And, Anarchy actually has dealt Faker his only game loss this season, interestingly enough.
How dare they?
And Faker's playing Orianna in that game. Speaking of Orianna.
Yep. Now, GBM originally learned Orianna because he was impressed by the way Faker played it, and he wanted to play that champion the same way, and he nearly got there. Pretty much got there.
I'm a bit surprised that the Orianna came out here instead of something like the Zed or like the Ahri, both of which GBM can play just fine. And we've seen success even after the Deathmark nerfs with Zed players playing into Victor and getting kills.
I just feel like it's a comfort thing for Jhin Air. You know, they're like, all right, if we're going to go to another really late game, we want GBM on something that he's absolutely comfortable with, something that he can make plays with late game. And
yeah, the weird thing is GBM hasn't played this champion in a really long time, where he's played Ahri much more recently, so...
Not competitively, but we don't know what's going on in scrims, and I haven't looked at his solo queue account recently. So maybe. Looks like it'll be Krug start for OQ and Watch. And Watch will just go ahead and take the big one, and OQ will go to lane.
Yeah, Pilot and Che going, getting some experience, though, actually. Taking the little golems just to get a slight lead in the laning phase. They've been very concerned with the fact that OQ is so good in the lane. So they're actually going to level up one creep earlier.
Hmm.
Now we'll see if Najin understands this. They should.
Probably. Now, we'll see what kind of plays Chaser can make on this Evelynn. He's been very deadly with it in the past, and he looks like he wants to try something on Goom early here.
Yeah, level 2 gank.
Maybe, yeah, it looks like he's going to give it up, but that's the type of thing that where if you pull it off, you're hoping for a summoner spell maybe used. Not really going to get any kills, but if you can get the flash, that's great.
So Jhin Eir has established a little bit of lane dominance as a result of that faster level 2. In this game, so at least they're trying to get more pressure over the bottom side, which is something that Jhin Eir has really been lacking in this series so far.
Yeah. Wow, Pilot. Looking much more bold this game, too.
Well, he's in a favorable matchup, so he has a little bit more leeway to play aggressively, that's for sure.
Yep.
And watch here. Go ahead and clear out the camps. No attempts at early ganks from this Lee Sin. Mm-hmm. And we'll see if he can attain the same level of vision control that Najin has had in the previous two games, which has been pretty favorable for them.
Yeah. I'm really, really curious to see a little bit of action in the top lane, but I'm really curious to see what the dragons are going to look like early on. Because it seems like Jhin Eir is finally saying, all right, we really want to.
They can't let that happen again. It's way too risky where they had to. I mean, they basically were between a rock and a hard place where they had to bust out some really fancy rotational play around the Dragon and the Baron late last game, and they executed it. But you don't want to be in a spot where that is a necessity.
Not really. Not too fun.
Also, it was just so weird that that second Dragon went unkilled for so long in that last game, even though both teams, I feel, had angles onto it at times, and they just weren't decisive with their advantages. It was kind of disappointing.
It's like a good 25 minutes without a dragon, which is almost unheard of.
It wasn't that long.
Was it? It felt like it. 20 minutes?
No.
15?
No. Maybe like 8 or 10 minutes on that second dragon where it was just sitting there alive.
Feels like an eternity without kills going on. It was.
It was an eternity. This is your purgatory, Noah. Jhin Eir versus Najin is your purgatory.
Oh.
Hour-long games with very few kills.
It's tough, man. I'm surprised I'm enjoying it as much as I have been. I'm afraid of what that might mean, Monty.
You're becoming a gentleman of taste.
I guess so. My grunge rock roots are at risk here.
Because grunge rock is equated with lots of kills?
It's equated with lots of taste. I don't know. I don't know where to go on this one.
Well, Trace is playing these lanes pretty smart. He hasn't given Watch really any reasonable attempts to go ahead and get a gank off in this top side. He's been playing much better than he did against CJ.
Yeah, they do look a bit tighter.
Even though he only plays two champions still.
Hey, but you gotta play those champions well.
What happens if Maokai or Rumble gets nerfed? What happens to Jhin Eir?
That's a good question. We'll probably find that out by the end of the year. Especially with Maokai, I would think.
Well, Rumble's getting buffed through that AP itemization change next patch.
Well, so he doesn't have to worry about that anyway. But Maokai, that's where the point of concern comes in. It's okay, Jax just got buffed, so he can just become a carry, play Jax.
It's very odd to see Trace, who had such a big champion pool last season and now is just playing the only same two champions every single game. And yeah, they are power picks for sure. Like, it's not wrong to pick them, but it's weird that Jhin Eir does seem to be limiting themselves or becoming so predictable in the draft in that way.
You got to wonder, too, if maybe they're just kind of hiding what they've got up their sleeves for as long as they can, too.
I don't know if they have much up their sleeves. I'm not convinced yet. I'm not convinced yet.
And Trace usually has his sleeves rolled up, too, so maybe you're right. Can't be. There's not much room to hide things there.
This is where he tricks you, though. You think he's got nothing, but he's got top Morgana up there.
He does, like, a lot of magic acts where he pulls out, like, Irelia and stuff like that. Top Morgana. Top Nautilus.
Maybe his top Rengar is still hiding up there from back in the day. What do you mean, oh no, he was great on Rengar. Just Rengar is terrible now.
Rengar these days, yeah, that's what I was about.
But back in the day when it was his crazy pocket pick that had to be banned every game, it was hilarious.
Yeah, well then it was great. I mean, that's how he came into the league. Yep. Was as a crazy good top Rengar player. A pick Mach Noon would have approved of.
Back when AP Rengar was broken.
Yep. And then when he was still really strong after AP Rengar was nerfed. Well, not a lot of action early on in this game, as you may have noticed.
Shocking. It really is just this series quite slow.
Don't worry, I think there's going to be plenty of action in our second series.
Yes.
That one should be that one should be pretty fast and furious. Oh. Yeah, why not? Or not. Don't go in. Not a lot of warding coming in from Jhin Error, and it makes it tough for GBM to engage here. Oh, Flash Dredge Line. They get the Flash out of Che as well, so support Flash for support Flash.
Nice attempt to make a play. They had
why not
Lee Sin in the river, so they could have definitely turned that into something good.
Yeah.
Watching Goon. Shockwave
comes in. Evelyn Alt used as well, too. Can Chaser keep the damage up until GBM gets there? Doesn't look like it. They do chunk Goong and watch out, though, and so that may give Jhin Error this first dragon.
Yeah, GBM did want to flash there, too, because Goong still had his summoner spells available.
Yeah, and his ult.
And if he had gotten hit by that ult, if he and Eve had grouped up right there in the river, that could have been very bad and a good turnaround. But they get some nice chunk damage down, and you know, if you're a Najin, you can't be clearing wards like that.
It's a bit risky.
Or they didn't know the ward was there, but you can't group like that, because if GBM can see you, then you're going to get hit by a two-man shockwave. So
apparently
not the best play there from Najin.
Watch coming up to the top lane, but no opportunities with Trace playing safe. No dragons yet.
Trace has really been playing this lane well. The fact that he's only down like 10 CS right now, he's going to pick some more up off of this wave while he has made it pretty much impossible to for himself to get ganked has been very nice to see. And you know, if there's a Lee Sin Maokai lane, that's obviously where the jungler is going to be going, because they don't have a lot of kill pressure anywhere else yet.
Right.
Corki's still ramping up. You don't want to go down and try and fight the Sivir or Thresh, especially if their jungler ends up being there. So it's pretty transparent where Watch has the highest kill pressure and where he's going to go. And Trace has just been playing suitably cautiously without losing hardly anything in terms of XP or in terms of his farm. So good lane play.
I feel like we're seeing Jhin Error try to be a bit more aggressive with the warding as well, too.
Well,
they've got one behind.
Their warding has been pretty sad tonight overall. Now, Chaser knows that ward's there, but he's not going to kill it.
They had a few pretty good ones until a moment ago.
So, doesn't kill the ward because he doesn't want them to know where he is until he clears the pink. Then doubles back to take the other one out. So, smart play there, just leaving the ward up as long as he has to make sure he can get everything. Now, ward on the Grump, trying to check out where Chaser is. And he could do some sort of lantern play here with the Sivir ultimate. This could be big, actually. GBM has kept Victor zoned out.
OQ is on his own down there, too. Doesn't look like they're going to catch him, though.
Oh, but they might.
Maybe. Yeah.
This is really dangerous for Najin.
Yep. Watch. Pure in a little bit of trouble. Oh, but they caught Chaser in first blood going over to Pure. Wow, that was a really fast turnaround when they knew where he was, and immediately onto Dragon goes Najin.
Yeah, and right there, it was a good read. OQ was already in the river just waiting for that to happen, so Najin gets the pick. That was a dangerous play for Najin to make, especially since Sivir ult is on the other team, but Pilot and Che were not there to back him up. And Chaser obviously thought that something, there was a miscommunication there at 100%.
I think so, yeah. Kind of makes you wonder again, you know, where that, how much that shot calling from Captain Jack is helping Jhin Error, because they still look a little bit off tonight.
Man, Pilot had to have better communication in that situation about where the wave was and if he was going to be able to get into the river to back it up. I also think that they had a chance to lantern gank with the Sivir ult earlier on when Chaser was in the tribe rush. So.
Well, they've looked so indecisive in the early parts of all three games already now.
Yeah.
And even though they came back and won last night, the last one was pretty impressive. Shea gets a bit caught here, plays away. Watch comes in. He's going to drop the box. Can he get over the wall? No flash right now. Shield from GBM. Nice three-man shockwave for GBM. And, oh, the hook misses for Shea. Thought maybe they would have an opportunity with that to turn around. Close call. Dodgen keeps walking into these shockwaves from GBM, and if they keep doing that, that's going to end up in a pretty good team fight for Jhin'er at some point in this game.
Eventually, yes. Yeah. However, right there, it was Che's misplay. He was, again, just there by himself in a zone that they knew wasn't warded in their favor at the moment because they just lost a member during a warding mission from Watch and Pure. So, still dangerous play on the map from Jhin'er. Definitely not where you want to be.
I would say so. Watch is just going to go ahead and grab the small things. It looks like, oh, can he grab Red?
He's waiting for Smite.
He's got the Smite. Yep, there we go. Now he has health to do it. Probably.
Yeah,
he should. Yep. He likes to live dangerously.
Yeah, just waiting for his Smite to come back up. It had a couple more seconds. And when you Smite that Bramble back, you get the health back, even if you have just... You don't have a Ranger's Trailblazer, so.
Yep.
It's nice.
Get that health right back. Smiting the Bramble back. Good old Bramble back.
Chase are actually going for Trailblazer this game. And are they going to go just throwing a hook out there, an exploratory hook?
Well, there was a ward, so Pure was able to avoid that fairly easily.
I think Chase should just say screw it and flash play these guys. And then.
Hell yeah.
Lantern the Evelynn in. And just try and make a play.
Wow. That sounds like something I would say right there.
No, I think there's opportunities. I think there's opportunities. But the way Jhin'er is warding is preventing them from actually playing aggressively. Look at where these pinks are. They just want to play a very conservative early game. They're not too big on making the plays right now. And without more wards in the bottom side and without knowing where Watch is, of course they're going to be reluctant to take any kind of risk, but they're not actually setting themselves up in a way to take risks either.
Yeah. I think back what I said about Jhin'er's warding early on. It's still looking pretty bad in this game.
Yep. Yes, it is.
Yeah. I don't know. It's odd. It's odd to see it fall off this much, you know? It's like Jhin'er's just like, all right, we're just going to kind of get behind early on, and then when it gets super late game where nobody has any wards, then we're going to find our picks. We're going to find our team fits.
Well, they need to make a play soon. Hopefully, for Jhin'er, what would be ideal for them is they try and get the Infinity Edge to balance out the Trinity Force from Corki, and then try and make a play at the Dragon with the Equalizer, especially since Duke has delayed his Righteous Glory by building a Cowl for the laning phase. Not sure what Chaser was even doing up there. Chaser is not having the best series tonight. Chaser just was waiting there, but there was no chance really that Watch would be up there to gank when Rumble was that close to the turret. And ganking for a Rumble with Evelynn, I mean, there's just no crowd control there,
yeah,
really.
You've got two slows, and that's about it.
Yeah, it's not. Probably not going to kill a Maokai with a Cowl through his ultimate.
Not likely. Oh, Pure likely to die here, though. Has a flashback into the wall. There's a Shockwave bringing in OQ as well, too. They try to escape. Pilot flashes over the wall to get away from that one, or actually just runs
lantern
up there. Teleport comes down, and there's a Lantern. They bring him in. A lot of damage from Trace. Drops the Equalizer. Doesn't catch anybody. Flash Harpoon to slow down Goon. Can they get him? A lot of damage coming in. They don't catch him with the slow, though. They get the flash, though. And wow, they're still chasing, but Goon finally gets away. A minute before Dragon comes up, though. So Jhin'er has a chance to ward. They have a chance to push up this mid lane. They might lose their top lane for it, though.
Yeah, Duke canceled his TP over the course of that engagement. Now, Goon can still clear out this wave. He's got Watch there to turn around any gank. So how much can Najin take? Because if they get a turret off of this, that one death is going to be very beneficial for Najin. Like, this actually was an advantage for Najin in the end because Jhin'er couldn't take enough.
So what happens if Jhin'er is able to get the Dragon and tie things up? Does that make it worth it?
If they got enough wards down, but they're not going to get the Scuttle Crab, and everyone's going to be back up for Najin. Duke also, since no one has TP, Trace is going to have to stay in the top side. I'm not even sure that Jhin'er is going to be able to contest this because Duke's just going to walk straight down to the Dragon more than likely.
They've got wards, but like you said, I mean, Najin's going to be back there in time.
I mean, Pure was should not have been there either.
Yeah.
They had enough wards down on that side. Pure walking in alone.
OQ nearly got caught out there as well, too. Crucially, that kill went on to GBM, so he'll be able to get a nice little boost in gold that way. Already has his Athenes done and another needlessly large rod besides that. Looks like he's just going for a lot of damage early on.
Najin could have already started this dragon.
Well, gives Jhin Air a chance. But the vision for Najin, as it has been all series long, is really good right now.
So Najin's waiting on the depth charge, and Jhin Air's waiting on two of their ultimates from Eve and Thresh.
Yeah.
Hence the delay, but Najin had a few seconds to go ahead and start this without a whole lot of harassment. Still just going to play it defensively. Watch actually gets poked a lot.
It still kind of remains to be seen if, as the game goes on, Watch is going to be able to make plays on this Lee Sin. I think that could be a real advantage for Jhin Air in the later stages of the game. Watch can't quite handle it, can't quite make the plays. He's not really going to be the greatest front line.
Oh, here we go.
Ultimate activated. Sivir coming in, and there's the equalizer. They get a lot of slows. Ultimate used on Goong as well, too. Jhin gets caught out. A lot of damage, and here comes Duke in the back line. Ultimate onto Chaser as well. Jhin Air doing a lot of damage. Trace roasting everybody, and GBM finds a chance to do some as well. There's a kill for him, and Jhin Air probably can't take a dragon off of this, but at least they go even for kills in the team fight.
And they can take a mid lane turret. So Jhin Air still is able to stick around and push this wave forward. Nope. Actually, Goong is just going to come back. He's very, very low.
Yeah, but with no real playmaking opportunity for GBM, he's perfectly safe to clear this wave.
Now, Jhin Air really forced that fight. Yeah. They didn't have any kind of flank with Evelynn. So they tried to just run at them, which made this pretty not ideal, actually, because the Equalizer not doing a whole lot. The Evelynn ult also kind of whiffs, and everybody gets caught inside Victor's gravity field because
great
they walk
wave
into a choke. The only thing that's keeping Jhin Air in this game is GBM's ults. I mean, they have been great so far this game, but the general engaged decision-making for Jhin Air this series has been poor.
Yeah. So far, the question if GBM's Orianna is still good is a resounding yes.
Yeah. Impressive. You should play it more often.
Guess so.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with Jhin Air's planning for these team fights.
Oh, they lose their bottom turret. Wow. Yeah. They're just not getting a whole lot.
Well, at least they got the dragon.
That is something.
Goong stuck around with a flashing red health bar just to clear the wave and make sure the mid turret wasn't taken, which gave Jhin Air enough priority just to get onto the objective in the river. And they traded for a tower, which, you know, as we get past the 20-minute mark, probably will be worthwhile.
Yeah, true enough. And a little bit of damage onto the tier 2 and bottom as well. And more great warding from Najin, allowing OQ to put some pressure on here. Yeah, Jhin Air still with a lot of work to do positionally in this game. They don't have a lot of map control right now.
It's just weird to see Jhin Air playing their compositions so poorly, which is Jhin Air has a specific style of play with their kiting, and it's like they're trying to play their kite comps as heavy engage comps, and it's just been met with such limited amounts of success in this series.
Well, we'll just have to continue hoping GBM makes the plays. But right now, Najin is making all the wards, and that's making it very easy to pull a little bit of a siege on this tier 2.
Possible gank coming in top.
Maybe. No, doesn't look like Jhin Air finds anything there.
Well, Chaser's just here to to counter-engage in case they get collapsed on. There's no reason why he can't help take this top turret down while there's nothing happening on the other side of the map.
True enough. And Duke just going to take the blue buff, it looks like. But will he be able to get back in time to... Well, I guess he's going to give it over GBM, of course, but... Looks like he'll be able to save his turret, too. Yeah, Jhin'er not able to push it far enough ahead. They just don't have vision. They can't go that far up, I suppose.
Not safely, and that's taking up a lot of Chaser's time.
Yeah.
The lack of wards is actually making it so that Chaser has fewer things that he can do on the map because he has to walk top to just help back up Rumble as Trace extends really far down the lane.
It's been a bizarre series for Jhin'er.
Yeah, it's so different than the last time they played because Chaser just absolutely crushed Najin in that series, and he just hasn't been playing very well tonight.
Well, it seems like we're not seeing him be as aggressive as he usually is in terms of getting wards in terms of like making plays, shutting down Watch.
There have been hardly any deep wards for Jhin'er in three games now. That is not a good sign.
Yeah, it's very bizarre. Yeah, it's just really weird because, I mean, how do you go from really good vision to just suddenly forgetting to ward? Like, how does that happen?
And GBM's still doing his GBM thing, which is building that warding totem in the mid lane.
Yep.
And upgrading it very early on.
Well, he's been warding. It's just, seems like Chaser hasn't been able, like you said, get in the enemy jungle and put down the deep wards.
Yeah, but how does Najin have more wards on the map when they are actually down a upgraded warding trinket? This is strange.
Oh, looks like Jhin'er's going to take the top turret, at least. And that may be a signal to try to take the tier 2. And there's Equalizer. Yeah, Trace knows, so he's going to make sure that doesn't happen.
Trace has been playing the map so well this game. Nice job by Najin, though, to zone out GBM on the tower.
Yeah,
threat the kick, and there's no Equalizer, so good rotation by Najin. Can't take the bottom turret, but you can be aggressive and force GBM off to take the mid.
Now, dragon up in a minute 20 now. One dragon apiece. It's really all about the turret so far in terms of the little lead that Najin has, along with those wards. There we go, upgraded sweeping lens now for Chaser, so they can start to clear out some of the wards in the enemy, or in their own jungle, I should say. Probably.
Watch has an Aegis now. That'll be very important to the next teamfight, and GBM has no mana. He has to recall before this fight, but Jhin'er is going to have to be overextended without that turret in the mid lane, so Najin should have an advantage going into this third dragon.
It just doesn't look like Jhin'er is going to be able to get all the wards out of their own jungle, too, so Najin's going to be able to very comfortably position themselves when the dragon comes up.
Yeah, they're starting to clear them out, and they have that wolf spirit just in case Najin tries to get any more deep wards in.
I guess. Still, though, I mean, you can see Najin kind of just sitting there watching Jhin'er come through the jungle. And GBM will get the blue buff.
He has his death cap now, so he is at a good point to fight.
That is true.
Or he starts to get very scary once she gets her Void Staff.
Abyssal Scepter and Aegis, though, on Najin, so how much is that really going to do? I mean, it does a lot to Pure, but how much is it going to do in a team fight?
Yeah, that is a bit problematic, and that's why he really needs that Void Staff.
Hmm.
So, Jhin'er looking at this dragon now. They have the pink wards, but Chaser's not even trying to go for a flank here. He's not trying to wrap around the pit. To be fair, Najin does have really good pink wards to prevent an engage from the side or from the rear.
Yep. Well, recalls for both top laners getting ready to teleport into this fight if they need to. And here comes GBM.
They know where he is.
Yeah.
So they're going to take the Scuttler, and are they actually just going to start this? Both top laners having the time just to walk.
Yeah. Oh, here we go. Najin starting that dragon. It's on Jhin'er to stop this from happening, and they're seen coming in. Here we go. Equalizer goes down right at the mouth of the Baron or Dragon Pit. They catch Pure immediately. Dragon still might be taken, but Duke forced the flash. Now they're going to turn the Dragon. Do they get it? Chaser comes in, smites away the Dragon, and now Najin on their run. Flash over the wall from Trace. Shockwave still hasn't been used. There it is, bringing OQ in, and Watch still in, but no follow-up from Jhinair, though.
Well, they forced the heal from OQ.
I guess so. They got the Dragon, too. That
they
was
got
really
the
nice.
Dragon on the steal. Pretty split call there from Najin as to where and how they were going to go, but Trace opened that up with a very nice equalizer.
Yeah, and now it looks like Najin's going to be able to take the mid lane tier 1 as well, too. Jhinair, rather. So Jhinair is still kind of living and dying by their team fighting in this series.
Yeah, and that time it was better. They actually had the good engage onto Pure right there. They managed to take him out right before that fight started, and then Najin couldn't decide how they were going to engage. They chased out Duke from the team fight, isolated him so that he couldn't get onto the back line while his front line was still there.
And this is the first time that Jhinair has been ahead in Dragons all series, too.
Yeah, this is much better early Dragon control from Jhinair. They have picked it up. At least they're willing to fight now for the Dragons, and they have a bit more engaged this time with the Evelynn Rumble combo.
Yeah, Chase seems to be performing pretty well on this Thresh as well. Pilot being the Scuttle Crab.
That's what you gotta do sometimes.
Yep. Sometimes you're Vayne making the plays, and sometimes you're the Scuttle Crab.
AD carries hate being the Scuttle Crab.
Scuttle Crabs hate him. Find these 10 easy secrets to take out the Scuttle Crab.
To make your team really fast and give vision?
That's right. Jhinair needs it. They still don't get a lot of deep wards after that Dragon, too. Warding up Baron, which, you know, I suppose should be the priority right now. Uh-oh, Duke gets flayed in. They're going to bring people in with the Lantern as well. Duke knocking people away with the Arcane Smash. Still on the run. Pure can't really help here. Nice death sentence, and it is a death sentence for Duke as they finally take him down. GBM with another kill there.
And they prepped the wave well, so the wave is coming in. Jhinair finally starting to ward better. Gets that Baron control, and then is able to make the pick. They have the Equalizer just to clear out the mid wave.
It's not going to be enough. Oh, it is going to be enough. Okay.
Yes, it is. They don't have a tank there to actually face tank the turret against the Rumble if necessary, so Najin just has to back off. They could get caught right here.
I was going
to
say, Najin might be getting caught in a bit of a hard place here. Goong on the run, turns around, lays on that gravity field, but Chaser uses the ult to slow down Goong. Ult onto Che as well, but they're going to turn around. Jhinair backing away. GBM forced to flash over the wall, but it looks like they've caught Pure. Chaser with another kill there. And now OQ trying to follow, but he's got to turn around. A lot of damage onto Trace, but looks like Jhinair is going to get out of this one.
Yeah, they have the Command Protect and the Dissonance just to get that little bit of extra speed up. So
They've also got the people to protect that Tier 2 turret in mid as well.
Yes, they have very good wave clear this game. So that threat onto the Tier 2 has ended, but Jhinair actually translating the pick into something. Now Duke has to go make sure his Tier 1 doesn't die in the bottom lane.
Probably a good idea. Wow, so Jhinair starting to come together a little bit. Enough, anyway, to get a bit of a lead. Funny thing is, like, it's about a 2,000 gold lead, and this is still kind of one of the bigger leads we've seen in this series. It's been very close.
It has been. I mean, the last game ended with, what, 1,000 gold advantage or so?
Yeah.
For Jhinair, so extremely back and forth. GBM really turning in a pretty solid performance on this Orianna, as we've come to expect from him.
Yep. 3-0-2 so far. Has that Void Staff, has the Seeker's Arm Guard even. And in very good shape so far.
So Jhinair, now they have a chance here to just bait the Baron and start really forcing things. So they should take this. They have control over the side waves right now.
They've got some deep wards too in Najin's jungle as well, so they can put some pressure onto it. They don't really need this next Dragon too. The Baron is Much more juicy target for Jhenair at the moment. They might just be dragon crazy this game. They want all the dragons.
They've got dragon crazy after not having any in the last, or not having that many, I should say, in the last couple.
Yeah, they got a couple. Ended up with three in the last game. Only two in the first, though.
Yeah, they managed to stall out that fifth dragon stack, made sure that Najin never got it.
Yeah. Three times, actually. It's pretty impressive. Dragon up in 20 seconds about now. Wards in favor of Najin in a big way, but you gotta wonder, if they see Najin going for this dragon, do they just immediately run up to Baron?
No, they're just gonna go for the dragon. You know, they have the wave pushed up. They force Duke into the top side right now while they have five, so you can at least get the teleport here if you're Jhenair and you start this dragon immediately.
And they've got the Scuttlecrab as well, too.
Yep, and there are no good... Well, there's one good ward on the side there for... I mean, they could just... Well, Duke's already here, so he managed to clear out that wave in time.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, ping's going down from Jhenair in that top lane. They know that lane is going to keep pushing in their favor. Should, anyway. Yep, it will.
Najin can't take this with the Scuttlecrab there. Chaser's going to try and get a flank. Now, they need to bait Najin to try and move forward into this choke point and see if they can bait them into placing a ward. Oh, Chaser gets seen. Oh, he has to be careful.
Yeah, Duke's going to engage on him. Here comes OQ as well. The ball comes in. Command protect. Chaser chasing. Couldn't get to OQ in time for a good shockwave, but Jhenair might have an edge.
Very preemptive Sivir ult.
Yeah.
Totally unnecessary.
Oh, and now Pilot's going to get jumped on by Duke as well. Manages to spell shield the Twisted Advance, but takes a lot of damage from Goong in the meantime.
Pilot Sivir is really underwhelming. You can't make that kind of mistake. Now, they're going to try and get up over into the Baron side to see maybe what they can do up there.
Dragon's gotten taken too fast by Najin, though. They can't go for the Baron.
They might have been able to set up a bait there if they had cleared out the vision. Now, there's a huge minion wave in topside, and it is doing work. And one thing Jhenair has been very successful at this series is setting up side wave pushes.
That's true.
They've taken like three or four tier twos now with, you know, minion waves.
When they see OQ in bottom lane, can they just start this Baron?
Well, OQ's not going to be going to bottom lane right now.
Oh, so. I mean in top lane rather to...
No.
This wasn't close enough.
No, too close.
Yeah.
Plus you're going to get poked out by the Victor, and Victor is a very nice champion just to drop a Chaos Storm in and win yourself a little dragon or Baron fight.
Why not? Well, Jhenair just working on pushing up those side lanes again. GBM has some decent gold to go back and spend at this point. Getting ever closer to that Zhonya's. Gonna have enough to get the needlessly large rod and sell his Doran's ring. Ha ha ha, I'm just kidding. He's never gonna sell his ring. He's gonna wait till he has a full Zhonya's.
No, he should sell it for a pink ward.
That's even more ridiculous. What are you talking about? He's
I know.
Got
how
the upgraded boarding trinket.
How dare I suggest that carries should buy Ward Stoa?
Silly. You call yourself an analyst. Oh, Chaser gets seen again. Still going to do a little bit of damage with the good old Spikes of Hate. If you think about it, what really happens with hate spikes, if you get hit by that once, you should just be kind of like down for the count. I don't think you're going to survive.
Tears up your feet. Uh-oh.
Oh, Sivir ult activated. They're going to run through the gravity shield. There's a nice equalizer, though. Have they slowed down people enough? Jhenair looking a bit undecided about where to go here.
Yeah, they didn't get a lot of damage down there. They used a lot of ults to do that.
Yeah, they did. They kind of split and then kind of milled around. They're like, who do we want to go for? And by then it was too late. Getting some wards in, at least.
And they forced Duke's teleport. That's actually a major win.
Yeah. It does help. Now moving over to the mid lane for a bit of siege, but there's not much siege to speak of with this Jhenair team, not with a Sivir.
Well, getting Duke's teleport out is actually huge because in this series, Jhenair has successfully manipulated the side waves in ways that they get objectives off of it. And when Duke doesn't have the TP, Najin really doesn't play well. around getting those minion waves in a good position. So that actually is going to buy them about 5 minutes of time where they can take out these bottom turrets with minion waves. And they can still commit. Uh-oh, GBM gets caught.
Yeah, he does. Gets out in the Lantern, though. Twisted Vance in onto Chaser, and he almost gets taken out. Meanwhile, Descendants onto OQ. Shockwave only pulls in Duke. They barely missed OQ.
And Trace's Equalizer was 2 seconds away from being up. Now, he could drop it, but now they lost that TP advantage that they had had.
Yeah. Really close. Man, OQ is just on the edge of that Shockwave.
And yeah, OQ got up way too far. He actually got a handful of auto attacks from Pilot.
Yeah. If he had gotten caught, he would have been in big trouble. Well, not a lot of gold to be spent on the Jhin Air side of things at the moment. Trace, he should have enough for his Zhonya's very soon.
Yeah, that's going to be a big buy.
Yeah, only about 200 gold away, I think.
400 should be 450. 450.
He's got it. Yep. Well, two Zhonya's on the side of Jhin Air now. That's a good way to survive Victor damage if you
also
get yourself in a good position.
A good way to not get kicked by Watch.
Yes.
Especially if you are GBM and the most vulnerable person to eating a Lee Sin kick because you don't have a spell shield like Sivir does.
It's very true.
Just Sivir is a champion. Seems to be everything that Pilot isn't. I mean, you have to be so willing to just run up in your opponent's face and play in the front line as Sivir. And Pilot's such a cautious positional carry that he just hasn't been able to translate that into success. However, what has been successful is Trace setting up yet another slow push in the bottom side.
Gets him a tier 1 turret. So just like you said,
Trace is playing so well this game around minion waves and minion wave control that his laning phase was so good, not giving the enemy any kind of chance at all to get a kill on him in lane. And then he's been just masterfully orchestrating these slow pushes that Najin just can't respond to.
It allows
look at this wave.
Jhin Air
it's
to
huge.
Put a lot of pressure on Baron, too.
Yeah, especially right now. They've got the Scuttlecrab.
But they're going for it.
They're not really
going to
do this. They're going to back off, but
well, I don't know. That Baron's going down really fast. Chaepwood's down the box. They're going for it. They're going to get it. And now they're going to turn. They grab Pure. Pure getting away with his own dredge line. Watch on the run already. They're just going to chase him. Righteous Glory gets the slow there. Now the ult from Chaser comes in. An easy pick. And now they can just turn around. They don't even need to fight this anymore.
Just
take the blue buff and move off.
This was some very good shot calling from Jhin Air. I thought they couldn't do that or that they were just going to turn off and let that minion wave kill the tier 2. But look at the timing. They build up this minion wave. It starts shoving in. They get nearly two turrets, maybe two, depending on how these minions actually stack up here in the bottom side. And they get a Baron based on Goon's recall.
Wow. Najin, meanwhile, they respond with a dragon, so that will be their second of the game. But here comes Najin.
One minion wave, two towers. Excellent side wave control.
Wow, yeah. Wow, that one wave, without any additional damage from Jhin Air, takes down two towers.
And the decisive shot calling, too, has really stepped up from Jhin Air this game. They saw when they had that timing, and they just immediately went for the Baron.
Yeah, and again, we've got a 6,000 gold lead right now. I think that's the biggest lead we've had in a game so far tonight.
Yeah, it's been a very close series. So Pilot's just going to go clean up the jungle right now.
Or is he? Suspense.
I think he was scared because he didn't have wards.
Yeah. I think you're right. Well, Najin pushing up the mid lane again a little bit.
So now they have a chance to siege, but Jhin Air's siege is not awesome. It's like GBM going for a Luden's Echo as his final item in this game.
He sold the Doran's Ring. Hooray! Shouted from the rooftops.
But he didn't buy a pink ward.
Hooray! Oh.
Oh.
Oh, I mean, not hooray.
So what is Jhin Air doing in the enemy jungle right now? They need to take out that tier 2 before they seriously commit to an inhibitor push. They may try and split push with this Evelynn just a little bit. But you only needed one person in that top side, and the rest of them should be pushing in mid lane. That's a little weird.
Everybody grouping mid now.
Yeah, Trace has to go bottom at some point here. They're, Jhin'er's on a clock to actually take out this turret.
Well, they're moving in. Doing a little bit of damage there. But, yep, Siege from Sivir, not the best. Wow, look at that, though. Wards in the enemy jungle. Huh.
I didn't know you could put wards there.
Yeah. We haven't seen it all series from Jhin'er until right now. Pretty much.
Pretty much.
Yeah, they're going to send Trace to deal with that wave in bottom lane. They had to do something.
Still, they really haven't done very much with this Baron buff, but that is partially a compositional issue. And the good wave clear from Najin on the entry with the line wave clear from Victor is difficult to handle.
I really don't think that Jhin'er is too concerned about making large strides forward with this Baron buff. I think they're just happy to keep it away from Najin.
Well, they could also just continually fight and take more and more advantages right now, extend that gold lead.
Yeah, exactly.
Unfortunately for them, they're not really on the cusp of that Dragon number 5. Got a long way to go in that regard. It'd take over and he'd be getting to like the hour-long point by the time they actually got a fifth Dragon.
Yep. Almost got there last game. Another large rod picked up by Trace. He's going to go for that
Death Cap.
Death Cap, yep. For some reason, I wanted to say Void Staff. I think I was looking at his inventory and I saw the Void Staff, so my brain said, you want to say Void Staff right now. I'm like, no, brain, no, but it came out anyway. Oh, well. Thanks, brain.
Always tricking you.
I know.
Doing what you don't want it to do.
I should just leave it at home.
You should just meditate more.
Turn it off. Meditate more?
Yeah. That's how you turn it off, yeah.
What type of music should I put on when I meditate?
Zero.
Oh. You don't meditate with music?
No, that would be distracting.
Oh. Doesn't help you get in the zone?
No. No, it does not.
If you have a very active imagination, though, it can give you something to focus on, which narrows...
But the point of meditation is not to imagine things.
I know, right? But if I just sit there with my eyes closed, I'm going to start imagining things.
No, that's how you train meditation. You focus on not having thought.
Well, we've both got a long way to go before we're Dhalsim from Street Fighter.
Some of us longer than others, it seems.
Hey, I can stretch out my arms and say, yoga. I'm almost like Dhalsim already. Oh, Chaser steals the big wolf. And look at this. Just like we saw last game, Dragon and Baron coming up at almost the same time again.
Yeah, Baron up enough in the future, though, or in advance, that they actually are going to be able to pretty easily get this Baron buff, or at least force the face check. Finally, Jhin'er has figured out how to lock down vision control around the objective.
They figured out that all it takes is wards.
Buying them, or maybe using the two sight stones and the two warding totems that you already have.
It's the it's the tricky part, the balance between buying and using wards. The flank is real. Chaser comes in, big four-man. Wow, that equalizer goes down as well, too. Chaser gets very low to Goon, though. And have they poked people out enough to do Baron? I don't know. That looked really good coming in, but then didn't really do as much. If they would have had a good shockwave,
there wasn't enough follow-up. Pilot and GBM were unable to actually put damage down there. So Chaser and Trace did work, but no one else really in range to get the necessary damage down.
I thought they were going to be close enough, but I guess not.
And now they're in a situation where they don't have ults.
And they really need to stop Najin from taking a fourth dragon, too.
Yeah, that would be pretty high on the old priority list. Fortunately, Agony's Embrace will be up pretty much by the time this dragon is, or shortly thereafter, so low cooldown on that ultimate.
True enough. And they may just grab the dragon anyway. No, they're going to go back to mid. Equalizer getting closer to being up as well, too, and they still do have Shockwave, which is a pretty big deal, because we've seen what GBM's been able to do with it this game. All right, they're just going to go after the dragon.
Yeah, plenty of time before the Baron starts. We saw Naja did this in 8 seconds before the Baron began last game. Now Chaser just going to sprint out 1 second. Now Baron is live. They have a ward on there, so they're going to know that Najin's not doing it. And they're just going to push mid lane. I mean, screw it at this point.
Why not? Oh, Chaser throws a ward down. Immediately he knows they use a sweeping lens because it immediately didn't work for a couple seconds.
What is Najin doing?
They are trying to bait.
And Trace is standing at a ward, too. I mean...
Oh, they're going to lose the turret, I guess.
Jhenair should just keep pushing. I mean, screw this. They can just take an inhibitor. Well, Najin has to go for it at this point.
And Jhenair's going to try to catch them. All the ults up now. Oh, this could be gravity field used very early. There's a pretty good equalizer locking them into the pit. Chaser harassing. There's a nice Agonese embrace. He goes in. Oh, he steals Baron as well, too. And now GBM comes into the big shockwave to set up some kills. They do lose Trace, but they're going to take Duke immediately afterwards.
And GBM's still going. They have a chance to make plays here. OQ may be full HP, but Goong is low.
Oh,
here
Chaser.
Comes Chaser from around the side. They're boxing him in.
Yep, Goong very low health. Here comes Pilot. That's the big threat. Gravity field use. Oh, he got him with the return on the Boomerang Blade. Double kill as he takes out Lee Sin as well. Watch going down there. Only OQ remaining. And there's a Flash Blade. That does a ton of damage to OQ, actually. They get the Flash from him as well, too. Chaser running up very, very fast. It's the great OQ chase 2015. Meanwhile, there's a big wave in top lane, and they will turn for the inhibitor. I think that's a smart decision.
Jhenair has just displayed significantly better late-game decision-making than Najin, and that's what's going to earn them the win here. These death timers are so long, and they have the Baron buff. Should be easy.
OQ can't save them. There goes turret number one in front of the Nexus. Nexus turret number two goes down as well. And there goes the Nexus. So great late game play from Jhenair. And they will take this series 2-1. Wow, what a crazy series.
And high fives from Sweet and the booth. Coaches coming in.
Yeah.
Very questionable, I will say, early game decision making and warding from Jhenair. But they pulled it together late game in games 2 and 3 and did make some extremely good calls. I mean, right there. They had the vision to just let them know exactly what was going on, and they forced Najin into a very poor decision where basically Najin stuck around that Baron so long looking for the miracle pick that their only choice was trade inhibitor, like, or lose an inhibitor, or they had to start that Baron.
Yeah.
And then it was just easy to get turned around on by Jhenair.
Well, Jhenair continues to be, you know, the